So to follow LaGrange, ZZ Top, let to follow LaGrange, ZZ Top let Hill do the singing via recording as Francis, who's the new bass player, Beard and Gibbons played Tush, and the fans got exactly what they were looking for, which wasn't much more than a boogieing good time.
Oh, he surely wrote that.
He actually wrote that. And the closing line of the review is really deep and cosmic roundup to the whole review, which goes as follows. Opening the concert was Samantha Fish, a bluesy guitarist of considerable note. Now,
wait, that's it?
That's it. Now, if the reviewer, John Bream, when I read that translation, I'm terrified of a woman guitar player in a skirt that can just rip my face off with a guitar. So we're just going to leave it right there and get the hell out of here before I say something really stupid.
Well, either that or he didn't take her seriously enough to show up and even catch her set. That's what I was thinking, you know?
That's certainly what it looks like. I posted an excerpt of an interview she did recently. She's got a new album out, I guess. And where she commented that she's gotten rid of her pedals in the interest of focusing on her technique and her craft.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, a bunch of people jumped in and were like, well, you know, pedals, and there's this application and that application. And yeah, I get all that. If you're in a cover band or if you're in a worship environment, or blah, I get all that. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a new upcoming artist that's already made an impact, a lot of talent, really focused on being a guitar player and getting great reviews and playing her ass off, playing lots of gigs. She's getting out there, you know?
She's working. She's been at this shit forever.
And you know, those kind of people don't get talked about enough. And when they do get talked about, they get this dismissive shit like this, which really made me angry. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna put this out there because I think it's important and I think she deserves, you know, some kudos for that. And I sort of encouraged the followers on my personal face page, not the company page, to
opine.
Yeah. You know, like
debate, like discuss.
Almost like, yeah, join in, help throw the ladder out there. You know,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Joanne Connor we talked about.
Ooh, what a beast.
Who's a fiery talent, it's probably been around a long time, probably been ignored for a decade or two.
She's coming for everybody's head, man. You got to duck when she comes around.
And, you know, I mean, she's rough and raw looking and loud and proud, and she obviously couldn't give a rat's ass what anybody thinks about her because all she's there to do is tear it up. And she comes up.
Yeah,
with the Les Paul down around her knees and the neck up here, the total turkey leg thing with the slide, just going for it, right? Going for it. And my wife and I are looking at that going, holy shit, look at that. She's fucking wailing. She's tearing her whole audience a new asshole. Check it out.
Oh, yeah.
And like, yes, yes, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So seeing and seeing the and having, you know, seen some of the Samantha Fish stuff and just going, yeah, more of that, more of that, more of that. And one guy posted, yeah, now all she needs to be doing is using fried amps. And I'm like, no, because then that'll be your excuse to say, oh, well, she sounds good because she's using better gear. You know, like, fuck that. She's one of those people that could play through a Gorilla amp and sound good, you know, and be exciting. So I took great umbrage at that ZZ Top review where this guy just like
what's that guy called
on and on and on, and his whole review is this roly-poly kind of boring spew, you know, and at the very end, the opening act, who probably killed it on her set, you know, got this, oh yeah, and she was there.
I can't get yeah. no. Yeah. What was that guy called again?
John Bream.
John Bream. Okay.
Yeah, so let him know what you think of that.
So he doesn't get a Christmas card from the Fryettes this year is what
absolutely
you're saying.
Absolutely not. No siree, Bob.
So what else is on the agenda?
Hey, boys and girls, good to see you here. Thanks for showing up.
Yeah, hey, we got all our buddies showing up talking about libations. Oh, wow, there's a lot.
Don Robin. Let's see. White Kratom? 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 What's that?
I'm still at this locale. I'm still on the Wee Beastie tip for the moment until this bottle's gone. It's just fine. Not exactly a summertime dram, but what do you got there? Oh, you had that before. I recognize
that. Back to the Tequila Ocho, which you can see I've barely scratched the surface on. And
were you drinking that last episode?
Episode before. No, the last episode, it didn't matter. I was just drinking myself into oblivion. I was already lit before the show started.
Oh yeah, and I knew that. You showed up to set up, and it was drastic.
Yeah, we went to a restaurant and grabbed a little snack earlier in the day because I don't like to eat right before the show. I don't want to get dragged down, you know. So we went to just the local watering hole and like, yeah, I don't want to get lit for the show, you know. I just want to eat light, you know. So I order a margarita, of course. That's how I don't get drunk.
Wait, how did margarita and eat go together? You went to eat light and you got a margarita?
Well, I thought it was going to be a lightweight margarita. You know, the place that we go to, the margaritas are usually very good tasting, but mild. And I thought, fine. So it was not mild. It took me this much time between the last show and this show, which feels like a month to me. Joe says it's only 2 weeks, but it feels like a month since our last show. But I needed that month to grow my eyebrows back after those margaritas. And it was so good, and it smacked me down so hard. I'm like, yeah, I'll have another one of those. And then we're getting ready to, you know, we're getting ready to wrap up. And the bartender goes, you guys need anything else before you go? And my wife goes, well, I'll have another of whatever she was drinking. And I went, okay, well, I'll have another round. So that was by the time I got home, I'm woo. And then I started drinking port. The port that I got for the show. And because of that, because I was already, the engines were already on fire, the next day I went and looked at that bottle of port and it was half gone. So if I was unintelligible or rambling or couldn't find ground zero with, you know, couldn't get my boots on if the instructions were on the bottom, that's why. And
yeah, you were good. You were just freewheeling.
Freewheeling. Yeah, I was talking about this music store that was across the street from Guitar Center in Sherman Oaks called Guitar Guitar. And I said, across Sunset in Sherman Oaks. So anybody that lives in the area is like, what the hell is he talking about? Sunset's in Hollywood. Ventura Boulevard is in Sherman Oaks. So I blew that one. And I was talking, and you would ask me about the Fret King guitar. And I said it was a Firebird kind of a vibe. It was Wilkinson's take on a Firebird. And then I described the sound as having that Thunderbird vibe, you know. So that's obviously I'm losing my mind. I couldn't think of the name of the shop or the city of this guitar shop that I had gone to in Phoenix. And it was in Tucson. And it's been there forever, since like the 30s.
I think we were saying like Tempe, Tucson, Scottsdale.
Yeah.
We're on a tour of Arizona.
Yeah. And so that was in Tucson. It was called the Chicago store. And so I imagine that the old critter that was running it, who was probably the owner at the time, is probably long gone. And but the store is still there, so that was a fun experience. And then, so when I'm getting ready to nod, I'm like being really, really careful. I didn't imbibe.
Well, but hold on, before you drink that, wait, that's water.
Sparkling Steve, water with ice. Yeah.
Steve, raise a glass.
Yep.
I'm going to tell you why. Because our buddy John Gormus over here, do you remember about a month ago, he talked about feeding the abandoned kitty?
Yeah.
And he's saying he just had to put it down.
I'm sorry.
That toast sucks so bad. So absolutely. Here's the toast.
And to you, John, for answering the call of the angels to put yourself out for a defenseless animal who needs us to care for them. That's
don't do it, Steve. We're gonna get open up an onion and start getting cryy again.
No, it's cool. I just have a thing about cats, having lost three in the last 10 years.
Well, my cat, I don't know where she is around here, but she's 13. She has cancer. My dog just had ACL surgery yesterday to the tune of $8,000. Pets can be expensive. What are you going to do, man?
Yeah. Yeah. Right on, John. There's a credit card company that specializes in veterinary services.
In what way?
It's just a credit card that sort of specializes in dealing with veterinarians. It's called Care Credit.
Huh.
And you know, you can put the services on that card, and it's a separate card just for kind of understand the whole process of veterinary medicine and stuff like that.
Credit Care.
Yeah, this when we had it was called Care Credit, but it's probably the same thing. That's a good thing to know. So yeah, we've taken advantage of that in the past, and that's like there's a whole industry wrapped around that, and good thing.
So
going back to the tequila, I just figured it's tequila. I'm not going to get into it too hard, or maybe we will later. I'm just not going to do it right now. There's too many interesting things to talk about. But it's called Single Estate Tequila Ocho. And I thought, okay, I've never heard single estate before. So I looked it up. I Googled single estate, and every Google response returned was Tequila Ocho. So apparently that's their bailiwick. And apparently they have different estates.
Steve, that's their touring circuit.
Yeah. We'll get to that. Apparently this is a thing. They've got different areas where each different agave plant has its own sort of unique characteristics. So they bottle according to the specific area or the estate where those agaves come from, and it gives each different expression its own little personality. And this particular one, you know, they've got the serial number on there and the date and all of that stuff. So it's a little family operation. It's all hand done. It's really great, great stuff.
Tastes great, which that's
It's got this sort of pineapple and plantain sort of notes coming off of it. It's very sippable. It's also, you can slam it. It's good for slamming. It's good for sipping. Another thing that's also good for slamming and sipping is Casamigos.
Oh, hell yeah.
Now, I got this for the show, but I realized that that I barely touched the Ocho, so I decided not to open this time. I just brought it for fun to show you. And also, the reason I bought it is because I had just done a show last Friday. I got a thing off my bucket list, which was really awesome. I played at the Greek and I played with some old buddies in a band called Animotion. They had a hit single in the 80s called Obsession, and you know, an early 80s keyboardy techno kind of.
And you sang on it, right? That was you?
Absolutely not. I just played on their album, but I wasn't actually officially in the band. I just played on their album, and then when their single took off, I was already doing other projects. They were kind of going back and forth and back and forth with the record labels and negotiating, and we're going to release it and we're not going to release it, and the usual head games that record labels played on artists. And I had no time for that, so I bailed. I was off doing a couple of other original products and touring with.
I thought you were going to say I was off doing blow.
There was a lot of partying going on during that time. I won't lie, but I just when they finally had everything nailed down, I was already committed to an East Coast tour with the Dickies, and it was just like, I didn't know how well they were going to do, and they turned out having one hit, you know, and they did a tour and they were like rock stars for a minute and great. But I was having a ball, making good money, playing punk rock. And,
I
didn't join the band. And anyway, but I stayed friends with them, especially the main lead singer, Bill, who I was friends with before that band started, before all that even happened. We were friends.
Who brought you in? Did he bring you in? Those sessions?
Yeah. And, so I did the thing, and the rest of the band thought, oh, you're perfect for us and blah, blah, blah. Join. And the manager tried to pay me behind the band's back, pay me to join the band without telling them that I was being paid.
I love that.
And I was just like, no effing way am I going to do that. That's the perfect.
I love that story.
You know, there's an example of how stories like that go. And they did a movie about it called 2001, A Space Odyssey. And the main character in point was Hal 9000. Where they had to lie about his mission and he went nuts. So I had visions of that in my head when they were.
I've been on every side of that story that you possibly can. I've been the guy who's been playing and find out that somebody's been being paid in the band when I wasn't getting paid as much. I've been the person who's been paid when nobody else was paid. I've been being paid when nobody else was paid and I didn't know that was happening. Like all these sorts of stupid scenarios. But you, the guitar that you used on that gig was the same guitar that you were tracking that record with, right?
Mm-hmm. That's like why I brought it.
How many years ago? That's so cool.
Yeah, 35 years ago.
Wow.
And the day of the show, the day of the show, 35 years after the record came out, it was certified gold. That day that I played that gig.
No.
I got certified gold. Yeah.
Wow, that's
so that was hilarious. But yeah, first live gig in 15 years, first time playing with those guys in 20 years, no sound check, no rehearsal, 10 minutes to set up in front of 5,000 people at the Greek, and I
all the ingredients of instant genius.
5 days to prepare. He called me on a Sunday night and said, are you free Friday? Yeah, what's going on? Well, can you play a gig? Yeah, sure. I can carve out Friday night for you. Where is it? The Greek. I'm like, okay, what could go wrong? So I spent the rest of the week, getting my act together to do, I practiced the song, played it until we were, you know, everybody at work was sick of hearing it, you know, and I had to like.
You were doing that at the shop? That's hysterical.
I was doing it at the shop. I was doing it at home. And I'm trying to figure out, okay, I got to build a rig because they're going to have a back line. They're renting a whole back line of stuff, and it's going to be broken down twins, broken down JCM 900, the two channel one with a solid state front end.
Yeah
no,
and the sweet cab,
but it's a 15 acts on the bill, you know, and each one has got 2-3 songs, and then you're out. So the back line is all set up, and they've got 2 drum kits, 2 drum risers set up on the stage. So as soon as one band leaves, the other band can start immediately come up and get their shit together and then play their songs and off. So they're just like running them through like a cattle wash. And there was no time, but I was not going to play through that effing back line. No, not me.
Not you. Not the master cylinder.
I had to figure
Malcontent.
I had to figure out why I'm taking the master cylinder moniker tonight is Master Cylinder is a character in Felix the Cat cartoons.
Beautiful.
And when I was recording the record, I was having a little battle of wits with the producer, and his name will come to me in a minute. John.
John Bryan. John Bryan.
No.
Why am I thinking that? John. You told me. John. Starts with a B, I believe.
John Ryan. He had worked with Santana and some other people. Chicago. He was out of Chicago. John Ryan. Anyway, we immediately hit it off because I'm a non-smoker and he's chomping cigars all the time. He was this big, masculine, sort of arrogant, you know, look down in your nose on, I know everything, you know nothing kind of a guy. So just the right kind of guy for me to lock horns with, right? Way too much attitude, way too little experience, but I'm not going to let some guy with a stogie sticking out of his face tell me what to do.
Do you let anyone tell you what to do? That's the real question.
And I had gotten a pair of Felix the Cat slippers for my birthday. And I loved those things. I wore them to the session. I wore them to the studio. There's a picture of me from 1984 somewhere wearing those.
Oh, and we don't have it.
So I wore them.
Is this John?
Yeah.
That's the dude?
Yeah.
The stogie chomping.
Yeah. I wore the Felix slippers for the sessions, and I also wore them for the showcase in front of the vice president of Mercury, who came down with John and a couple of other people to see a live showcase. We were playing at a big club, so I was wearing those, and they were like, your band's pretty good, but what's with the guy with the slippers? Anyway, that's where the master cylinder thing came in. And I was using this Esquire. So I thought, well, for old time's sake, I'll bring the Esquire. So I had to get my whole rig together. And I had to have something that I could just drag in real quick, throw in on top of the back line, and just I figured I'll bring a rig where I just plug into the speaker cabinet. That's why I was using the Marshall. If anybody's seen the video footage that I posted or is on YouTube of that gig at the last week, I'm playing through a Marshall cab, and that's a backline cab. So I had to use that because I couldn't bring my own cab. So I plugged it, and this is the rig. I brought an LX2 and a Sin2 with a Deliverance module and an Ultra Lead module. And I set up 4 presets with the little 4-button MIDI foot switcher that you can buy with it. And one channel LX2. Set up 16 ohms into the 412 cab. And I was like, I hope 50 watts is enough. And it was more than enough.
Purple curly cord.
Yeah, purple curly cord. I was going to bring a wireless, and you know, the wireless thing didn't quite pan out. So I ended up using the cord, and I went down to Sam Ash and bought a nano pedal board and threw together a quick pedal board. After all my ranting about pedals, well, I just needed a delay and a reverb, and I didn't have anything that I could program crutches. That was a single unit. Crutches. I just had a couple of pedals laying around, and so I put the delay and reverb pedal on the top just so I could reach it, because I wasn't going to be turning it on and off with my feet. I was just going to leave the reverb on a little bit and for their kind of music a little bit of slap, and that was it. You could barely even hear it on the tracks. So that goes into the loop of the synergy. All done. Put a couple of covers on the thing. The nano pedal board comes a little bag. That went in the bag with the cables. The guitar in a guitar bag. Whoosh, on my way. Get down there. I had 10 minutes to set up, and I was set up, ready to go, and in tune in 3 minutes flat. And then the song came. They started the song. It was, we started with a percussion track and some little keyboard sort of things, backing track. And then they had their regular keyboard player and drummer who came on. And then, so I sort of had a little support network behind me because I had the arrangements already in my head, and there was tracks sort of to play with. And Bill and the other singer, Astrid, are really pro, you know, so they're really good at cueing where the changes were and stuff like that. Although it turned out I had it pretty well locked in my head. I didn't really have rely on them for the cues, but they were there. So even though the cues weren't, you know, oh, I need those cues, even though they, I didn't need them, it was nice to have them just sort of a reinforcement.
Okay, okay, the most important question, though.
Where does Casamigos come into the story?
No. The jacket.
That's my NAMM jacket. That's my NAMM jacket.
Talk about this jacket, my friend.
Before the 2018 NAMM.
That is snaz.
A week before the 2018 NAMM show, my wife was at Macy's looking for some stuff, and we were walking out the door, and I saw they had these a rack of blazers on sale, and she goes, "Oh, would you like a new jacket?" And I go, "Oh, I don't think so." And then, wait a minute, what the hell? And I saw this little sparkly thing, and I went over, and I went, and my wife is going, and I'm going, no. See, we have this thing when I'm buying shoes, really ugly shoes look good on me. So if we walk by the shoe department and I see, she says, "What do you think of that?" I go, "Oh, that's hideous." She goes, "Well, then you should try it on." And of course, it always looks good on me.
Okay.
So I pointed out the jacket, and she's going, no. And it's actually, you can just Google Animotion in the last week, Animotion Obsession for the last week. And there's a few people that have live videos posted of there of that show. So you don't have to rely on my Instagram or my Facebook to find it. In fact, you'll probably find better quality ones of somebody else that posted more close up, and they're just better sounding. So I just said, "Check this out." And she goes, "Oh, no. I grabbed it and I put it on, and she went, "You know what? I like that." So I bought it. It was on sale, $99. And so when I was thinking about, and I bought these, I found these silver sneakers, and I went, "Okay, I'm going to get those too."
They'll silver sneakers. You have silver sneakers. Shit.
Yeah. So I grabbed those for the NAMM show, and they were sitting in the closet. So when I started to think, well, okay, what am I going to wear for the show? Maybe I should be sort of nondescript so they don't stand out too much and blah, blah, blah. And then I thought, the jacket. I only worn it one or two occasions, right? So I grabbed it out of the closet with the silver shoes, and I just went, okay, this is it. Because that jacket went really great together. Some of the colors sort of matched with the Esquire, which is sort of a salmon pink color.
Some of the colors sort of match with the Esquire.
So I brought that, and I kept it in a bag, and then the band didn't know I had that, you know. So
you sprung it on.
We're in the dressing room getting ready, you know, chilling out, blah blah blah. So when I came out, I put the jacket on just before I walked out on stage, and the band were like,
"What's this? What
just happened?" You know. So it was a way of having fun with it. I talked to, by the way, guys out there. I talked to my personal therapist, Joe Gamble, about, you know, my past issues with stage fright and stuff like that. And he was just like, "Man, the only thing that you got to worry about stage fright is pretending that you have stage fright. So just get the fuck over it and get out there and have fun and do your thing." And so I followed his advice, and I wore my funky jacket, and I just felt like right at home. When we walked out, the sun had gone down. The place was packed. It was empty when we first got there. It was full. There was like 5,000 people. And I just went, I don't get stage fright instead in front of really big crowds. It's only when there's like 10 or 15 people, and I know there's nothing else to look at. But when there's 5,000 people out there, it's just like, I'm in my comfort zone. So I went, all right. And then when the song started, they all stood up. They all were real big fans of that band and that song in particular. So we just went, wow. And so then I forgot all about any nervousness whatsoever. And I just like played and it was over and it was great.
That's so great. So
after that, we went to the green room. And so Bill and I had a shot and I said, what do you got? And she says, well, I have this. I have Casamigos. And I went, Casamigos, Bill, you haven't tried Casamigos. Let's have the Casamigos añejo. And we each had a shot of that. And I'm like, God, that's just even after a thing like this, it's just even way better than I remember. So I'm going to buy a bottle for the show. So I bought a bottle for the show, but I'm not drinking it because I'm already into the Ocho.
It's in reserve.
It's in reserve.
Hey, we got a guest coming on tonight, folks.
We do. Couple of things before that, though. While I was in my, did I already talk about the Ventura? I already talked about the Firebird. I already talked about the shop in Tucson.
Yes.
I did my rant about Samantha Fish, who I think is an awesome guitar player. And I think the idea of her going out in an interview and saying, I'm focusing on my chops, is something that any guitar player ought to be able to relate to and go, that girl, that lady is for real. She's somebody you ought to be paying attention to. Bingo, the end on that. Thank you very much. And somebody asked something in here.
Brandon.
Oh, and I would have done it, and it wasn't about the money. I would have done it without the money. It was nice that they offered me a token amount of money because it was just like the gesture is great. I would have done it for free, but they did offer, and I accepted the offer because it was just like, sure, I did spend some money getting regular ready for it, so that covered it. And so yeah, that just about takes care of all the silliness. We've had a relationship with our next guest for a number of years now. He's a great guy. We basically bonded over tequila, and it's just been nothing but fun ever since. Laid back guy helping artists make great sounding guitar records. And when we got together, when we're getting ready to release the Power Load, and who can I talk to that's like got real guitar ears that can just like plug into the Power Load and just give me some off the cuff feedback, just so I feel the ground under my feet. I know it's good. I know we pretty much got it right, but never hurts to go to a resource if you've got one. If you know, smoke them if you got them. I gave Joe a call. Sure, come on down. He listened to it, he played with it, and he started getting on a roll with it, and like text messages, started getting some regular feedback that was all great. And we went over to his recording. Joe and I went over to his studio, which is just, it's like the most incredible guitar players paradise, sandbox, Ultimo man cave kind of vibe. And we just started shooting the shit, and I said, hey, Joe, this is the show. And he goes, yeah, I'll be on. So without further ado.
The man has intro music. Silver buttons all down her back. Oh, yeah.
She can't, so walking the dog.
Okay.
Because Joe was walking the dog before the show.
I was walking my dog, yeah.
Right. That needs a little context.
Hey, what time? I got to walk the dog. What time am I on?
Yeah.
So I have a few questions, actually. Do you still have the slippers?
That's a good question. Where the hell are they?
Because I wore them out.
We need to
find a photo of them somewhere. While we're talking, I'll dig them up. I'll dig up the picture of the slippers and of me at Audio Sound Recorders, something sound recorders on Cahuenga near Sunset in the 80s.
Or might have been a Grandmaster later on.
Yeah, you'll crack up.
Steve, while you're doing that, I'm going to ask Joe like the maybe the dumbest, most obvious question. He's probably answered like 500 times on these things.
Have I been to the Chicago store?
No!
Yes, I have.
That's actually funny. Where the hell did the nickname Evil Joe come from?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. Well, it's a skit. This guy named Mike Martini who does these prank phone calls, and he has this character called Evil Joe. And I was working on Judas Priest and Scott Travis, the drummer, used to be at Racer X.
Oh, yeah.
Racer X is tied in with Mike Martini. I think Mike Martini's brother plays bass with Paul Gilbert. So it was all tied in. So since I'm Joe, I became Evil Joe. And,
oh, okay. So it had nothing to do with you. Because I remember when, you know, who brought me to your studio first was John Ziegler. And he was saying, yeah, we're going to Evil Joe's studio. And, you know, I knew the building is, you know, being Kevin Gilbert's old spot. But I'm like, Evil Joe? Like, what's this guy going to be like? Yeah. A little intimidated.
Used to be Smiling Joe, but you know, I can't really.
Oh, okay. And then I meet you, and you're just the nicest guy. It's like, where's this evil thing coming?
You ask, but Evil Joe seemed to be a funnier thing, and then you know.
I like that. And then also, right when I met you, you were also you had all of these. Wasn't it like Joe Barresi for President stickers?
Yeah, because my manager, nobody can ever get my name right on a record or spell it right in anything. And I would always go, hey, it's wrong. Hey, it's wrong. Hey, and we checked the credits, and the credits would always be right until it came out, and then it would be wrong. And so he started sending these, you know, B-A-R-R with the backwards R's, E-S-I, whatever, and like a bumper sticker. And
yeah,
it was hilarious. So
for president, yeah, that's they look cool. Like
president stickers. Yeah,
yeah. Oh man. So let's see, Steve. Did you find it yet? You look like you're working pretty hard.
See, if you showed up at the gig with those slippers, that would have been the ultimate.
Yeah, it's like who cares about the Esquire being 35 years old? We want to see some 35-year-old Felix the Cat slippers.
I have some slippers that also have like a smiley face on them, and I like to wear those around too. They're super comfortable. Who says actually, slippers Joe, are for the bedroom?
I wouldn't be surprised if you had one of everything in your studio.
Pretty much.
Well, like
including the vocal disaster system.
Oh, right.
I still use it. Who's got that plug-in?
The thing that I remember seeing this time was the King Diamond action figure.
Dude, how about wait? I got a King Diamond poster here somewhere too from seeing him. I guess it's been 2 years now.
Where'd you find that action figure?
I have no idea. I think somebody gave it to me.
That's a thing of beauty.
Started with collecting Spice Girl stickers, you know, and graduated Diamond action figures. So I think that's maybe where the evil went from smiling to evil right there.
Oh, okay. Yeah, there it is. Spice Girls to Satanism. It's kind of a drastic joke.
Maybe the Spice Girls are really evil.
Yeah. So were you working on stuff today, Joe?
I was working on a Kahlua in my coffee this morning and a pina
That's
colada.
A good thing.
No, I'm actually just doing laundry. I stayed home today. I needed to get some things done. So took a break.
From drinking your laundry?
Well, you know, I always thought there should be a way where you're like when I used to live in an apartment, I have to go to the laundromat. I thought this is like an hour of time that's just wasted. I should be able to do something besides read a book, something educational.
Now
I've got a wash and dry in the back, but I do like to you know, get stuff done. So I start drinking. Why not?
So you're going down your to-do list and it's like laundry, get hammered. Do a little more laundry.
In the house.
On the Malcontents.
Exactly.
It's actually a bullet pointed thing. I got to get my hammerage in. Pound
every
my liver.
Once in a while, you know, you need to let the steam go every once in a while, and it's just as long as it's controllable. I'm still standing and talking.
So here's a question: are you doing summer drinking right now, or are you doing fall drinking?
I'm doing summer drinking. It's still summer for me. I've got no shoes on right now. I had flip flops on earlier. It started, I had an Aperol spritz. I mean, it's just easing my way in, you know. I'm like, Aperol spritz. It's like, isn't it the beginning of summer right now?
That's summer drinking.
Exactly. And now it's an aperitif, some Amaro, like, you know, it's an after dinner drink.
BMO's asking a question. Do you still have empty high watt cabs? Was that a thing? Where you had empty high watt cabs?
I was working on the Melvins. We were doing Stoner Witch, and I was friends with all the guys at High Watt, Fernandez, and they had a bunch of empty cabinets. So Buzz from the Melvins was looking for some 4x12, so we ended up buying empty 4x12s from them. I kept one. I think he might have bought, I don't know if he bought two or four. I still have mine. And it's not like the old high watts though. It's not ported, but it is a good looking cabinet with a nice weave on the front, and it's actually been used on. Man, I think I've had I don't remember what your Stoner Witch was, but I've had that cabinet in use for that long. And it's got 75 watt sessions in it at the time. It's cleaner for the low drop tune stuff. And back then, drop tuning was drop D. You know, now you right. got drop A or full A or
I think it's called Z minus now.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not even sure, but
yeah,
it's one finger guitar playing.
Right, exactly. And then it's spicy if you bring in the ring finger and add the ninth in the chord, like ooh,
it's so weird. Advanced now. I pick up guitar like that, and even yesterday I was playing a drop D guitar, and I was like, "Whoa, God, what chord is this?" And I have no idea where I'm at. Even though it's one finger, I still play it like I'm playing a normal tuned guitar. So
is it still kind of a thing where, I don't know, probably the caliber of bands that you work with, it's probably a different thing, but you know, kind of the conventional story would be people coming in playing really heavy music. Playing one finger guitar tend to come in, and when it's time to record, they're using way the hell too much gain, like just stuff that doesn't translate to recording. Do you wind up kind of having to deal with that, or do they kind of know what they're doing at that level typically?
I think the biggest thing about recording to me in general is you can't mess with somebody's thing. So if you're used to playing to a fuzz face, you know, I've always heard the stories of, I want to use my Les Paul, and then the producer makes them use a Strat or something.
Right.
My guitar. That never made sense to me. I mean, I have tools available that might stay better in tune sometimes, but I still like to start with your rig. I mean, you don't have to bring 4x12s unless it's very specific. Like, if you have Fane speakers, that's very specific.
Mm-hmm.
If your sound is built around a Fane, then you need to bring those Fanes. But if you play 75 watt Celestians, I got half a dozen 75 watt Celestian cabinets. So I'm not super concerned about that part of it, but I would never say plug into my Marshall if you played something else.
Right. Right. You
know, that might be what I add in to your something else, as something else to your thing. But, you know, I mean, sometimes I'm just like, this is going to be better with less gain. And you know, most guys are, you know, musicians are just, they're willing to try whatever. That's all I ever ask. I mean, you know, it's, but like I said, if you're used to playing super clean, I'm not going to say it needs to be dirtier. And I always say the part dictates the sound. So
sure. That makes sense.
You play the part, and then not only does that tell you what the sound is, it's the collection of junk that's surrounding it. You know, I mean, you can put John Bonham's drum sound in anything, but it's not going to sound like John Bonham in Led Zeppelin.
Right.
Don't compete, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and then it's almost...
Excuse me, just real quick, one thing. I sent you an email, Joe. So I sent you a picture of that email.
Which Joe?
Excellent.
Me? Joe. Yeah, you. Joe Gamble. So back to your comment, Joe Gamble, you were about to say.
Look. Okay, cool. So what was I going to say? Something about the inverse of what we're talking about, like, you know, you don't want to monkey with kind of an individual artist formula too much, because you want them to be comfortable, you know, making their art. But there has to be, you know, sometimes like you're listening to something and going, all right, how much, you know, the typical, you know, what am I going to have to do to fix this in the mix versus
right?
I think how much can we ameliorate this up front before we go to tape so that I don't have to, make miracles when everybody leaves, sort of thing.
Well, I mean, for me, it's, I don't know, sometimes you lose track of or lose sight of what the actual product is. I mean, if you try to make Metallica out of a punk band, that's never going to happen. You should worship the punk band for what they are. So I think the one thing is these bands have an identity, and that's awesome. Who wants to listen to the same band that sounds like everything else? I mean, they're all disposable at that point.
Right, right.
So you have to embrace what the band's about and kind of inject it with a little steroid to say, okay, maybe let's take you out of your comfort zone a little. Maybe, maybe there's a keyboard over there. Maybe we'll blast that keyboard through a Marshall stack or whatever. And or let's get inspired by some music and maybe, I don't know. It's just, to me, it's never cut and dry. The thing I do like about mixing later on is you kind of know what's going to work, but how somebody's technique is, that's more important. Watching how they play. If everything's a little sharp, who cares? You might just get a little cringe and go, oh man, it's a little sharp. But how many records did we listen to that are a little sharp or a little flat because of turntables?
Sure.
In the 70s, they used to do it intentionally. The tape machines were all ran at different speeds. So
right.
Intentionally speed up music. So it was faster on the radio so they can get that commercial in there. Or sometimes it felt more exciting. Sharp doesn't bother me at all if everybody's sharp. So,
You just get creamed at the gig when you're covering that band's tune and they're in E sharp and you're playing an E. So, of course, you're all wrong. Right. Dude, yeah, playing it right.
You can't play the same two different notes, but you can all be slightly sharp or slightly flat.
Isn't that funny how you can be like musically out of tune and then you can be completely non-musically out of tune? And it's like, what the hell is that about?
Boss tuner. Like, do you think the Beatles had a boss tuner? They would go over there and tap on a piano key and go, okay, everybody tune to that. Or even worse, they would just go, hey, I'm in tune. You tune to me. And then you just play. And it could have been A440 or might have been nothing close to that. But
right. Yeah.
No one really cares.
Does it sound like music?
I was listening to Chain of Fools the other day. And
that baritone guitar part?
That baritone guitar is the signature, this big, huge thing. Canvas on which the rest of the song is painted, right? But oh my god, is that guitar, like in hindsight, listening to it really closely, I listened to it loud and on a really good system for the first time in really a long time, and that guitar is so out of tune with the piano.
Oh really? That's interesting.
And
that's a great song.
And you wouldn't dare touch it because if you put that back in tune, it's almost like without mixing that guitar up front, that fact brings it up to the front without it actually sonically being up front. It's attention grabbing that pulls it up to the front of the mix for you. And you go, wow, I'd get fired if I did that in a recording session, but. those were days when the piano was probably out of tune too, but it didn't fucking matter. Everybody was just like, they're all playing live, first of all, right?
Yeah,
you do another take when somebody really fucks up and you have to stop and start over again. But if Leroy's a little sharp on the G string, no, we're not ruining a whole session for that, pal.
Well, I think most people tend to make everything tight and they don't realize that making everything super tight actually makes it smaller.
Yeah.
I get a lot of guitars that come in and they're quadrupled and I'm like, really?
Angus, we were just talking about that earlier.
You read an article ages ago about AC/DC. You got Angus on the right, you got Malcolm on the left, and after the solo, there's a little bit of rhythm guitar maybe in the middle, so the integrity of the sound doesn't go away, or the feel of it getting smaller at the end of the song or after the solo doesn't go away. So I don't need four guitars. I might add 40 guitars and not four guitars, but they're not exactly the same part, quadrupled and tightened. Just vocal, right. Same thing. You got everything that tightens vocals up. don't really care about tight vocals. It's that beauty of the difference between the two that makes them flange and phase a little bit.
Right. And like in heavy music, it makes me think of, you know, the first record that I can think of that they were really doing that sort of thing was the first Aussie solo record where they had Randy doing like triple tracking his solos and shit like that. Like that was kind of bizarre.
You know? Robert, I will say at that point, it was the guitar sound. It was the sound that he became. That became his signature guitar sound. So that's okay. I'm fully into that. I mean, Brian May wouldn't be Brian May without multi-tracking. But doing it, you know, it's not exactly tight. Randy Rose is a great guitar player, and he can play, but it's not perfect. And
if it was perfect,
it would just disappear. It's not like one performance. So it's that natural chorusing.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of throwing a chorus pedal on, he's chorusing himself, and I think that's awesome. I mean, to me, that's no pedal. I mean, we used to do it with tape machines, very speed the tape machine a little bit when you do the rhythm track.
Mm-hmm. And then, So you were a guitar player first, right? That's where you're coming from.
That's where I came from. Yeah, I just I started when I was 7, and you know, it's just one of those things. At some point, I can remember like the turning point in my life in high school where I was, you know, religiously read Guitar Player magazine, and you're always wondering what's going on in the studio or who's using what. And that's where you discover some guy's string gauge and some guy's pickups. And I remember Steve Vai talking about playing in his bedroom and hitting a note and listening to it sustain and then feedback and noticing the difference in tonality between a high, you know, an E open on the first string against the E on the 5th fret of the B string.
Right.
You know what I mean? And the different tonality of the way you fret it with your finger in it. It just kind of blew my mind that there was, you know, like on a piano, middle C is middle C, but on a guitar that could be in 5 or 6 different places. So
that
really was the turning point where I just thought there's something behind this that I really need to learn. And then I wanted to forget all the rules. So I studied theory for a while because it was fascinating to me. I couldn't tell you what the German 9-chord is right now, but when I was 18, I probably could have.
Well, you know what?
Maybe somebody can tell us.
If you had.
Yeah.
Felix, cat slippers.
Yeah.
You wouldn't need to know any of that stuff. Look at that.
That's awesome. And I'm giving the producer a cueing key off of my right hand there.
Cueing key.
Yeah, I'm telling John Ryan
the what cue to what.
he wasn't sure what he thought of me for the first week of tracking. He just like
what
looked
studio
at me.
Is that?
What?
What studio is that?
That was that place. I'd have to look it up. But it was something audio.
Wait a minute, Steve. Is this that session you were telling me about where you brought in a tape of a phone answering machine rant of an ex-girlfriend or some shit like that? Am I getting that right?
Joe, did you ever run across an engineer named Chris Mento?
Oh yeah. Yeah, he was great.
You said was.
I haven't seen him since the Sound City era. So
I couldn't find anything on him. I looked him up the other day, but he was the engineer on those sessions, and we struck up a friendship. And good guy. And we were going to be done about 8 o'clock or something like that. And we just got on a roll. And John says, let's just stay and get the rest of these things done. And I'm like, yeah, let's get it over with. So I went and I called my girlfriend at the time and I said, I'm not going to be able to make it to dinner. We're going to be here till midnight. Sorry. And she's like, well, I'm making dinner, you know? And I'm like, yeah, sorry. I'm going to be here. You just leave. And I'm like, you don't just walk out of a studio that they're like paying for. Right.
You look very happy in that picture.
Yeah. So she got very upset about that. And I had to go. So I said, look, I got to go. I have to go back and track. They're calling me. She's, I'm not done talking yet. Sorry, I got to go. I had to hang up. She wouldn't let me go, so I hung up. And I had to run back in, and Ryan's going, are you ready to get to work? And I'm like, yeah, I'm ready. I'm ready. Let's go. Let's carve. So we did. And we went to about midnight or so, went home, and I had one of those answering machines with a little cassette cartridge in it, just a regular standard size audio cassette. And it had this most scathing, blood-curdling, ripping, I hate you, die message on it that went on for like 15 minutes. It was unbelievable. Because that's what you could do with those cassettes. They would just run and run and run until you ran out of oxygen. But the best part of it was the very first 10 seconds. Stevie, you selfish little shit! And I was just like... So the next morning I thought about it and I went, I pulled the cassette out and I threw it in my guitar case and went to the session. And so we were working for a couple hours and then John split to go get some food. And so I was just hanging out with Chris shooting the shit. And I said, you have some kind of cassette player or something that you can like bring up on the console, right? And he goes, oh yeah, I got a cassette player right up over my head here. I can patch that in to the monitors. And I handed him the cassette and I said, listen to this. And he listened to it for a minute and he stops it and he goes, this is awesome. And I said, okay, I don't want to get you fired, but here's what I want you to do. When we get back to work, we'll start tracking again. And as soon as I do a take that John likes and he says, let's hear that back, would you hit play on that cassette, have that queued up and hit play? And I said, and I'll take full responsibility. If he flips, I'll take full responsibility for it so you don't get fired. I'll do whatever. And he goes, yeah, I'm down with that. So we were working a bit, you know, and fiddling around with stuff and then I did a part. And John goes, okay, let's listen to that one. And Mento looks at me like, you're serious about this? And I'm like, mm-hmm. And he hits play. And John is sitting there with his cigar, just staring at the monitors like this.
Here's the visual.
It was quite a rant. Again. He played about 5 minutes of it.
There's John.
He played about 4 or 5 minutes of it. And he was just like, Chris stopped it. I don't think Chris stopped it. I think he went over and he just sort of casually pulled the master faders down. Slowly. And he looked at me, he goes, that's pretty impressive. I'd like to run across the street and grab some Thai food. And then we were best buddies after that. He never gave me any more attitude.
That's awesome.
A lot of artistic latitude. He stopped doing that. I'm way above
you. Who the hell is this kid in here with Felix the Cat slippers playing answering machine tapes and getting bitched out? Like, what? Who the hell were you, Steve? Like,
I don't know. I think the last time
when we had Tim Pierce on, I forget what story you were telling, but I remember the punchline was, and that's when I realized I was never going to be a session musician.
Probably just a self-destructive sort of personality that, look, I only really want to do what I really want to do, and all this other stuff is a distraction, okay? So... But I need the experience and I need the money and I love to play. So to that extent, I'll concede that I can't do my own music, my own art, my own way, blah, blah, blah. But I'm not going to concede anything else to this environment, right? And if anything feels wrong about it to me, I probably won't walk out and blow a gig and lose money, but I won't object to getting thrown out. If you want to fire me, great, you know, kick my ass out, fine. I can deal with that. I can brag about it. Oh yeah, so-and-so, when they become famous. Yeah, so-and-so booted me out of his studio because I, you know, but.
Got into the group.
I wasn't a quitter. I'm not a quitter, but. if somebody doesn't want me around, they don't want me around.
Yeah, but you're cantankerous.
Yeah.
There's those spokes. I got this wrench.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
stick it in every once in a while.
I had a reputation of being hard to work with some people. And other people thought I was great to work with. And it was just, if I like the music, I will work my ass off for your music. And if it's just a gig and everybody around is just got their nose up their ass so far, like they feel like they're special and they're doing them a favor by carving me a little bit of space to be in their scene. It's just like, I don't need that. I went and did a jam session one time with a friend of mine and the people, and I went in there intending to do a good job at the jam. If I'm going
to
play,
you intended to do a good job at a jam.
I intended to go and put my best foot forward at a jam session. I wasn't going to go up there and just be boring and wheedly. When my time comes in the song, I'll step up. Right. That's what I thought I was doing. And afterwards I thought, that went all right. And everybody in the band was like, what do you think? You're the only guy on stage here.
Oh,
they just piled on. And I'm like,
did you go up there? What was it, a situation where you were just way too damn loud? Like, why would they say that?
I don't know.
That's pretty hostile words.
More than four bar solos.
They brought a girl up. They brought a girl up who had these sort of, you know, jazz bona fides and stuff, and so she's singing and emoting, and she's doing this thing with her hands. She's indicating the changes to the band members. You know, it's a two, it's a four, it's a five, it's a two back to the, and I'm just like going, yeah, no,
okay.
I'll just sort of lay way back until they leave me some space, and then I'll kind of let it out. And they like it, they don't like it. But boy, they did not like it. They were all like these session yo-cat guys. You know, they're very
tribal. Yeah, it's a clicky kind of thing.
Well, see, that just turns up my... That just makes me want to put the pokers out farther. You know, when people are like that, it's just... Like you gotta bull your way in. You gotta finesse your way into the little. I don't care about that. Your little sewing circle. I can care less.
That's
you invited me up on stage. You know, treat me with some respect. If you can't do that, I don't have to. I don't feel obligated. Yep. Rest in peace, a great, great dude, Ed.
Mr. Ed.
From the Mary Tyler Moore,
Ed Asner. Hell yeah.
Great humanitarian, intelligent person, great actor. He once said, and he's like one of those guys that doesn't let anybody tell him if he believes in something, he believes in something, period. He, in an interview, somebody asked him about something where he ruffled some people's feathers, and his response was, I feel no obligation to go back and pick up turds I may have left in my path. And I was like, right,
that's funny. That's funny. You know, I have to say, that's never been my bent. I was always somebody who really wanted to try and figure out how, I won't say fit in, but I just wanted to figure out, like, what are the rules here? How can I be good in these situations? And, you know, that's what I did for a really long time, was fitting into all of these different kind of scenes so I could get work. And I know exactly what you're talking about, you know, and there are different qualifications for every different genre that you're playing. But that's how I paid my bills forever. And I'm in a completely different stage in my life where I'm not interested in doing that at all anymore. If I never play on anybody else's stuff ever again, I do not care. But it's not coming from a place that, like you're describing, Steve. It's not like my energy's never been like this.
My energy's never not been like this.
You're just like,
it comes from my dad a bit, you know. Uh-huh. But it also, when I took a J job to pay my bills so that I could play the music I wanted to do and explore the things I wanted to explore. So I didn't feel like I had to go do all that stuff to get their money. I didn't need their money. I could get my money working, doing amp repairs, doing modifications, doing flipping amps and stuff like that. And I was making way better money doing that than I ever made playing any of these gigs. So I didn't really rely on that. So I could just, I could take it or leave it at that time. And yeah, young, full of vinegar and attitude and not feeling obligated to, I just didn't give that much. I've mellowed quite a bit since those days, but I still, stuff still gets to me. Stuff still, that makes me just go, fuck, I'm not doing that, you know, or there's a reason for doing this. Or
so, Joe, what you don't want to buy this amp, that's
okay, it's not your thing, right?
Because I imagine, you know, as a mix engineer, I mean, you know, you're getting notes on stuff all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, sometimes I say it's like flipping burgers, you know, you're okay. You want it medium? Okay. It's medium. Here you go. I don't want medium. What do you want? I want it well done. Okay. Let's make it well done. Here we go. It's well done. And then you hand it to them and they say, well, it's a little too well done. I'm like, well, what do you want? I want a veggie patty. I'm like, well, why are we making burgers? You know, but in the end, you have to. I mean, I'm a firm believer in integrity, man. So I've pushed up vocals before, and they're like louder. I'm like, really? Okay, maybe I don't get it. Maybe I don't understand what you're hearing. Let's go. I want to make you happy. I'm getting paid. I'm like, oh, you know, we're a service business. So, but at some point, if the vocal is so loud that the band sounds like headphone leakage, I'm out. See you later. And I have no problem just going, hey, I'm not your guy.
Uh huh.
See you later.
Uh-huh.
So because in the end your name goes on it anyway, and you get work with your name on stuff, you know what I mean? So I'm like
that's hilarious.
One of my
guys who I learned the most working in a professional studio from, he gave me this line. He said, here's what you do, or this is what I do, you know, when a client is just ruining stuff. He's like, you know, they're paying you, so you kind of, it's a fine line you're walking. But his line was, he'd say, okay, we can do that, but you can't put my name on the record. He said that he'd never had it where, when he'd say that, the artist would always go, oh, like, is it really that bad? Okay, maybe I should have a second think about, you know, what I'm pushing. And then they could kind of come to terms. But that was sort of the nuclear line.
Well,
we can do that. It's your record, but you got to take my name off it. It's bad.
I've pulled my name off a couple of records, and
I've kidding.
I've walked up many records, and I've gotten fired on many records too. You know, insubordinate or whatever you want to call it. You intimidated the guitar player was one of them. I had all kinds of great excuses, but in the end, it's your instinct. You know, you might feel bummed for a minute. Oh, I got fired, man. I'm going to never work again. That's usually the first thing. But
sure.
You know, but in the end, I mean, I'd rather bag your groceries than put out mediocre shit with my son. I'd be the greatest bagger of groceries ever.
God damn it, those bags will have amazing tone.
It's a fine line. I used to do a thing called a Joe mix. I would mix it like you wanted it. You don't want the flanger on the guitar. Cool. No problem. It's like, whatever. I'm not butthurt about it. So let's just do it. Whatever. And then you want the vocal that loud, but then I would do a Joe mix. Give me 20 minutes to do an alternate. And I would always, when you send the mixes off to the band, in the end, they're picking which mix. A lot of times they would pick the Joe mix, or I really like the chorus in the Joe mix, but maybe the verse is a little too wacky. And you would end up cutting that in. So, and it's not an ego thing for me. I don't care if you like it or not. You know, if you don't like it, then maybe I'm not your guy. You want me to make it organic, and then you play me back music that is obviously just samples on the drum kit. I'm like, it's not very organic. So let's make it organic. Okay. Is that not what you want? Oh, you want samples. Okay. Whatever. But if you actually want it to be sampled and you're coming to me and you want it to sound like somebody else, maybe you should just get to somebody else, you know.
That's interesting. I remember that same guy that I'm talking about, that same engineer slash producer, he would use that kind of line too, where he wouldn't make a John mix, but I remember in certain situations, like I remember on this one record, this artist had brought in a friend to play a guitar solo, and it wasn't really great. And then I came in as a session guy, played a solo, and the artist was like really torn, like, well, I should have my friend on the record. And finally John, you know, the producer, said, well, I know what's going on my mix.
Exactly.
So it's just kind of this messaging of like, yeah, like this, okay, you can have what you want, but this is the good version over here. The Joe mix.
The Joe mix. I mean, you know, in the end, so I mean, I'm not saying I know everything in the world. The band's gonna know who their fan base is and what they like. And obviously, all I can do is go, hey, if you play that note again, I'm gonna kill you, or something like that. You know, just kidding. I'm just, you know, you try to push people while you're working together, and you try to get the best out of them. And then yeah, it's only for the sake of the song. We're all serving the song in the end.
Absolutely. You know,
so.
And isn't it true that when you see somebody and they have a potential that they're not living up to, and you can see it, you have to try to get them to, you have to send some marker to them to get them the message that you're here. I can hear you being here, and all you have to do to get from here to here is just go, and here's how you do that. And exactly. And I've seen people not be receptive to that message, like I can't. And the minute I hear that, I kind of go, well, why not? What's stopping you? Is it a book? Is there a rule book? I always use that analogy. Show me in the book where the paragraph where it says you can't
do this.
Move it from here to here. Show me, you know.
The studio is an intimidating place. So that, I mean, just being a staff guy at Sound City, and seeing bands come in and seeing how comfortable they are, because Sound City is like an inside of a rehearsal room. You know, it's not a hospital. You're not afraid to put your Coke can on the corner and there's nobody going behind you and, you know, going, oh my God, you ruined the
veneer.
You dropped a little something on the carpet. Oh my God, we're going to have to get, you know, there's none of those so inhibitions. So when I have my own place, it was the same thing. I was like, I want it to be like a bedroom when you're 17. I want to put a guitar in the corner and have you be able to pick it up. And maybe it's an odd guitar with some weird tuning. And maybe you're playing something that, like I did it to Chris Cornell, actually, on the Soundgarden record. And I asked him to play a solo on something. And he's like, wow, we'll let Kim do it. And Kim's a great guitar player, but he wasn't in town yet. They were coming down. And I remember just putting on YouTube and trying to learn how to play the Rain song in that open G or whatever it is. And I had this guitar in the corner on the couch in this open tuning. And Chris was like a master of open tunings.
Mm-hmm.
And he just was like playing the guitar. Hey, what's this tuned up to? I'm like, I don't know, man, like the Rain song kind of thing, whatever, you know? And this is insignificant. And then all of a sudden the song is getting played back in the background and the guitar gets picked up and the formulation of a part comes. And it's already, of course, mic'd up and ready to go because you did that with your assistant the night before. And before you know, you have a guitar part without somebody going, oh my God, I need to sit here and think about a solo, or I'm dropping $4,000.
We only do perfect takes here.
Yes, no one cares.
Get ready to deliver a perfect take.
No one cares. I'd rather record the attitude, the perfection.
Well, just walking into your studio, you just immediately go, this is a place I could crash on the floor. I can order food out. I could go hang out in this old area, look at that cool sign. I could sort of wander around and just, it's so comfortable. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it is like a 17 year old's bedroom.
Yeah. There's like an auto harp and there's a marxophone and there's a slide whistle, although that gets disinfected when people start blowing through it, you know, and there's
a rain diamond action figure, damn it.
And people pick up the rain stick to like, what is this? Oh man, this would be cool in this song. That's how you did it. you know, the only thing I regret about Modern Records is you're not in the same building as somebody else.
Right.
You can't feed off that energy of another room, you know, which used to happen all the time. I mean, back to the days when you heard about, you know, Zeppelin and the Stones and the Beatles, and somebody was across the hall recording and they would stop in and lend a solo.
Yeah. Yeah.
It kind of sucks now that everybody's so separated. But
I was actually recording it at A&M Studios before it stopped being A&M. I was doing a track for some solo artist, and Robbie Robertson was across the hall working on some stuff. The guy that was the producer was going to be a guy whose name doesn't roll off of my tongue, so I'm going to have to dig for it. He's the guy that got involved with the Beats headphone thing with
Jimmy
Robertson.
Yeah, Jimmy Iovine was doing the sessions, and I'm in there in the small studio with my amps just cranked, and I'm playing this. Played a track and then another one over it and then another part and then another one over that. And I'm just like blazing for hours. And Joe Ciccarelli is the producer. And he's like, he kept going, stop a second. And you play it back and he goes, where's that come from? And he's like calling the staff engineer guy to come in. And he thinks there's something wrong in the console. And I go, what's the problem? And he goes, listen to this. And there's this track and there's this, going in the track, and I'm like, what the hell is that? And he goes, I don't know, but I don't hear it when we're not playing. It's only when you're playing. It's only when we're recording. So we go and we redo one of the tracks, and I stop suddenly for some reason, and we hear this, and I get, it's coming from the wall over there. And so I walk out of the studio, I pull the studio door open, and there is a moving blanket over the door that wasn't there before. And I pull back the moving blanket and I look out, and Iovine is up there on a ladder with a hammer, nailing moving blankets over the door to the studio because I'm bleeding over into his session.
That's awesome.
And I said, fuck, Iovine, Jesus. Oh, sorry, man. Sorry. I'm like, you know, I could have
called in and told us the
bleeding into Robertson's tracks. And I was like, look, I can turn it down. He goes, oh, no, it's fine. It's fine. He wasn't like, you got to stop doing that. You're wrecking my session. He was like, no, this will do it.
All the echo chambers are all the plates too are in the same room. So if you're cranking through a plate and somebody else is using the plate next to it, you can just like I've been in there before where I'm just
I
like,
never knew that
most obnoxious sound ever. I'm not even using the plate, but I'm going to pump the snare drum or the massive double kick part into the plate on full stun so it messes with the dude from whatever boy band is in the other room.
That's so awesome. Double kick.
Usually get like a phone call though from the management. Like,
that's a malcontent moment right there, doing shit like that. Joe, while you're on, I want to ask you some of these questions that we're getting from the peanut gallery here. Just the first one here is, what was Chevelle like to work with? If you have anything to offer.
I've actually done 4 records with those dudes.
So there's a lot of history.
Yeah. And I will tell you that they are open to whatever. And Pete is a very prolific writer. And Sam, his brother, plays drums. So there's that immediate bond between the two. And on the 4 records we did, their brother-in-law was the bass player. So there's this, it's a family thing. But my whole thing was these guys have had an illustrious career. I've loved a lot of their records. So where do you go from there? You know, so... When I went to their hometown or just north of Chicago to do a little pre-pro for the first record we did together. And when we came back to LA to start the record, just experimenting, you know. I mean, I remember we had a few days where things were kind of getting sorted out. And I remember just plugging Pete into the H3500 and just randomly just twisting the dial and hitting load on whatever preset it came on and playing a track that was unfinished that might not even turn into a song. And he was coming up with some interesting things, like willing to do whatever. The bass player never played keyboards on the record before. So I have a Hammond, a 100 or 103, whatever it's called, three in my studio. And
of course you do.
I got it in my car, actually. Somebody gave it to me. I'm like, if you can get it out of here, it's yours. So I got it in my car and it fit. But, you know, I plugged it in and Sam, the drummer, was listening to the song. And they're like, the beauty of my studio, there's no boundaries. There's no wall between the lounge. And that also sucks if you want privacy. But he was in the lounge checking out the track that's going down. And he had an idea for a part on it. And so he picks up a little Casio keyboard and kind of fumbles in a little keyboard.
Excuse me a sec. Sorry to interrupt you. But, Joe, are you hearing this voice canceling out? Joe's voice? Joe G? You
hearing? I can Joe hear him. Bruce? Okay. Is it not good on your end?
It's kind of phasing in and out. Maybe you can put the microphone closer to your mouth.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
All right. Can you see my bald head when I do that?
Yeah. Well, here, you can see mine.
All right. Wonder Trio activate.
So the long answer to that question was those guys were great, and one thing I'm super proud of with those guys is every record we've done together has been different. First one was a more rock record. The second one, Pete got really inspired by Ministry. He came in with some interesting demos that were direct guitar in the fuzz boxes. So my compromise was some fuzzy guitar, some guitars through the Palmer at the time. So it was more up front.
Yeah.
You know, the next record we did at another studio and it was more metal. It was aggressive and angry and slicing. We ended up using a John Petrucci Mesa on a lot of the guitar tracks. It had that Mark IIc plus aggressive-y kind of thing. And then the last record we did was a little more like harkening back, a little more melodic, harkening back to some of the earlier stuff, but bold arrangements. I mean, I remember just, you know, watching this Kansas documentary and watching, I can't remember the producer now either, Jeff Glicksman, pushing up full of faders. And just there's, you know, Wayward Son instantly. Mm. And then there's a guy in the background counting. There's no click track. There's a guy going, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, you know, whatever. And so I encourage them to write some arrangements that maybe weren't normal, maybe a little bit bolder. And they totally took it on themselves to do it and rise up to the challenge and do it. And I'm super proud of those guys. They're very, not to mention they're just nice people.
Wow. So, that goes a long way.
Yeah.
Hey, while you're mentioning that, the count off on the Kansas tune, one of our buddies up higher, I'm not going to scroll back, but actually asked if you ever cut without a click these days, is that a thing ever?
Oh, all the time. I mean, for me, when I cut at my studio, when I'm doing a demo or when I'm listening to a band's demos, if the song feels good, it feels good. If the song feels a little weird, I'm always using the click track, the Dr. Beat or the Tama Rhythm Watch, trying to figure out where it sounds good. And usually the first couple of days of pre-pro, you're jamming the song, sometimes without a click, sometimes with a click. I personally love to start with a click, and then I might take it off when the drummer's doing a fill going from the verse to the chorus. And maybe then I've got, you know, the Dr. Beat going from 120 to 128. And then I kick it on the beat while the drummer's playing. And then it would go back into the verse. Hang on a second, turn the click off. He does the thing into the verse. And when it's a little established, I kick it back down to 120 or whatever. I'm performing the click just like.
I was going to say, you're sneaky.
Well, I mean, it's to me, it's like, I you know, some music has to be grid edited top to bottom. It has to be very specific, but, you know, some of it's just boring like that. And you know, you constantly fight. It was so much easier with a tape machine, honestly, because if something felt slow or fast, you slow it down. If you slowed it down, it got heavier because the tuning changed. If you sped it up, it got a little more sprightly. So it felt better. But in a digital world, it's a whole different beast. It's just too easy to take a performance and cut it up instantly. And a lot of times, like on a tape, you never did that. You'd record the song. I still, in my studio, I have a striped tape, reel one or whatever. And hey guys, we're gonna have the songs 4 minutes long. I can get 16 minutes. We're gonna cut four takes of the song, and then you would cut the tape together and you would do a master reel. All those Tool songs in the last two records were completely tape edited. You know, they're just a handful of takes, and you're listening back and making notes, and you spit it down to a two track at the same time, or spit it back into your Pro Tools rig, your M box.
Yeah.
Then you kind of do a fake edit on the stereo mix of it to see if it feels good. And if it does, then you go replicate it on the tape machine. It's just, I mean, there's,
wow.
And that, you know, it's funny. It's like you read on some forum that goes, wow, man, it was obviously cut to a click. And you don't even know what a normal drummer sounds like, dude. You know what I mean? Like, there's no click. Put a click on it. Hit the beat, you know? I mean, there's no click here. I mean, it's so ridiculous.
Oh, man, Charlie Watts did this thing that looks stiff when you watch him do it.
I'm grabbing water.
It was a swing.
But yeah, it's my theory that's part of why he has that interesting swing that he does. And what he does is it's on the hi-hat. He plays on the hi-hat. He does a rest, two, three, four, rest, two, three, four. So rest, right hand, rest, two, three, four, rest, two, three, four. And the snare drum is on the two and the four, right? Rest. And when I'm doing it, it doesn't convey the thing that he does, which is,
oh shit! Oh, I thought you're gonna hop behind the
stick. When the stick goes up, it's not like this. It's like you see the stick kind of go up and stop midair. So he's doing.
That's called style.
That's his own idiosyncratic.
It's his own idiosyncratic thing. Now I set up. I had my rig, my kit set up, and we were setting up the room for the show, and I was getting everything in place. And I haven't played my drums for a while, so I was kind of beating around on it. I was thinking about that. So I started playing that. I did two things. I played traditional grip, which I haven't done for a real long time. And I tried this rest, two, three, four hi-hat feel. And a really interesting thing happened. I started falling into this loping groove that I've never played before. I'd never played like that before. Real simple kick. One on the first time, two on the second time, one on the first time, two on the second time. And I realized that when I did that rest on the one, on the eighth notes on the hi-hat, it would focus my attention on the kick and the snare for that beat. And it made me approach the rhythm of playing the right hand, the left hand, and the foot differently, because I'm holding the hi-hat down with my left foot, so I'm not really timing so much with my left foot, but so my attention goes to the kick. So now my attention changed rhythmically just a little bit to where the whole feel of playing that part changed. So when I switched back to just playing straight quarter notes on the hi-hat, it felt completely different. I could play it with a swing, but the swing changed. Right. When I played it the way he played it, the swing shifted another way. And those are things that you don't, a click or a program drum kit, those are like little subtle things that players will pick up on and groove with. But
I mean, that's why you love those records, though. That's an identity.
Exactly.
That, you know, if that got ironed out, you wouldn't have that identity. So that's right.
When I first saw Charlie Watts doing that, I just thought, why is he doing this like stiff, real movement? Has he got some kind of, maybe arthritis is bothering him or something like that? And it turned out he's like refining a really distinct sort of stylized thing that only he does. You know, it was like the same thing with Ringo hitting the hi-hats like this instead of like this, swinging the stick sideways when he played the hi-hats on the hi-hats in the early days. He'd shake his head like this and swing his stick to the left and the right instead of up and down on the hi-hat.
Right.
With the hi-hat cymbals. And they would swish a certain way when you did that.
So
he had this really distinct signature because of the way he would swish the hi-hats with the stick sideways. And so Charlie developed this really signature groove by doing this sort of visually funny thing. But when you play it in the real world, it's like, oh, I totally get that.
Yeah. I mean,
and any players that are around you that are paying attention are going to go, yeah, I like it.
Exactly. Well, I mean, sometimes things get ironed out now a lot of times, you know, but it's tough. Like, it's really important, I think, for a band to be able to play their music together so you can get those things. Otherwise, if you start piecing them together, you might not hear that. You know, you might say, well, it's a little bizarre. Maybe you should straighten it out. And then you put the bass on or the guitars on and you kind of lost that personality. So it is important. Like, I'd love to track the band live, even if I'm not keeping it. That's why I was actually kind of excited to check out your IR loader, because up till now, I only have a big room. I don't really have ISO boots. So if I'm tracking a bass, it's usually with a Sans amp, and which sounds great. But in the end, then I have to recut the bass, unless I'm going to another studio or I have musicians that can play in the same room together where you don't care that the lead is in the drum kit. And then a lot of times on the guitars, I'll use their actual amp head because that's their sound. But it's usually through some kind of speaker simulator.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't know how many I have, probably five or six different speaker simulators. And they all kind of do a thing that's a little bit different. But sometimes it's a little too upfront and in your face compared to a real speaker. So it's, while you might keep some of it, I wouldn't say it's a quality rhythm track. So checking out your IR loader actually and playing to it made it feel a bit real to me, way more real, straight up. And even though it's still a head into a box, it actually had some of that pushback that you get while you're actually playing the guitar. So I'm kind of excited to check it out on another session now in my place where I can actually plug the guitar player into it and dial in an impulse response and just see if it, you know, it makes them play different as well. Because a lot of times, you know, I've tried pretty much everything. I've tried fly rigs. I've tried everything. And most good guitar players, they don't really care. They're like, okay, yeah, I get it. We're doing it as a scratch or whatever. And sometimes it leads to an incredibly cool part and you keep it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not those guys that records DIs and says, I'm going to reamp it later. I am anti record the DI and do it later. I commit to the sound right now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because that's it. And if it sucks and it doesn't end up working, but sometimes it does, you can replay it because you're a musician and you can play. Right? I'm not going to go in with plans to build a house and then go, well,
but I don't know, dude. That's a lot of pressure, you know?
I mean, it's so crazy. You're like, well, you don't put the roof on before you put the walls in there. That's what I don't even get.
But sometimes you do.
Dude, I can only play my own song one time.
Well, sometimes that is the truth, though. But you know, in the end, you do what has to be done. And
well, I was really thrilled when we came over. Joe Gamble and I went over to Joe Barresi's studio with the power load, with the intention of just shooting the shit a little bit, explaining it, you know, where we're coming from, what it's about, and what makes it different than what else is out there, And you were polite and you were going, yeah, let's try some things. And we tried some things there while we were there with the gear that you had. And we pulled out some guitars and an amp and just sort of messed around with it. And you're like, yeah, I can see this. I can't see myself doing this. And you're just sort of like figuring out the lay of the land. You're like, you're doing this assessment, which I appreciated right off the bat. If you were not interested at all, you'd be able to tell, you're like, yeah, I'll throw it up on the shelf over there and I'll give it a listen, you know, next week or something. And it would sit there and gather dust. But you weren't doing that. You were like going, yeah, I'm going to give this a genuine, you know, a few minutes of my time. And to people that the people that are here, that are watching, that are asking questions, what do you think of using our gear? Well, straight up, Joe really only uses our gear if the artists are already using it and bringing it in, or they're looking for some other sounds and he's just starting really to get familiar with some of the things we make. So he'll call and say, I need something that's like this, or I need something like that. He doesn't say, well, we have to have an ultra leader. It has to be a deliverance. He's just, well, this guy uses a lot of gain, or this guy is sort of used to this style of amp, or blah, blah, blah. And then he'll take a few things to try. And if something works, it works. And if something doesn't, doesn't. So I don't want to try to put him on the spot right now saying, you know, how do you like working with Fryad amps? Because it's all an organic process of sort of discovering what will work for him in the environment he's in with whoever artist he happens to be working with at that time. So that should sort of cover all that sort of background questions that our watchers, our viewers have. But beyond that, after we left the studio, I didn't bother you for a few days. I asked you one or two little key questions. And then a few days later,
leaving the PLIR with Joe, he had it.
Yeah. And I start getting texts, and from the messages I'm getting from you, I'm going, okay, I see where you're going with this. And then I'm going, oh, you should probably know that when you're using it like this, this is occurring. And you're, oh, okay, that helps me clarify my understanding of this part of the power load. And then you go, oh yeah, okay, now I see what you're saying about that. And blah, and we talked about where the level controls are set relative to where you like the sweet spot, where the sweet spot is on your mic pre's. Where you like to set the input level on your mic pre's, specifically the
Neves, I think
the Neve mic pre's, and I know that they have isolation. They have coupling transformers on the inputs. So I imagine, and I'm sure that you and a lot of other engineers. The word engineer is a little misleading. You probably, maybe you do, or maybe you don't know technically, electronically, what's happening in each of those stages.
I have no idea, man.
Read a schematic. But you do know that at this threshold, something is getting added to the stew, and it's repeatable. You set it here, it does this. At this level of signal coming into it, and that you identify that as your sweet spot. I get that information. I go look at a Neve mic pre schematic, and I go, I see what's happening. I can see the threshold. I can see the schematic. I can see how much level that circuit is set up to handle. I know how much is coming out of the power load and where you say you're setting the knob. And I go, okay. And you said, well, I have the levels on the output of the power load pretty high. Like you were thinking, by the time I get them up this high, maybe something should be happening, like it should be distorting, or should it be changing or morphing into something else? But I don't know. I'm not really hearing it, but this seems kind of high to me. And I'm like, no, you can turn it all the way up. It won't distort, or it won't change its personality. And you're like, oh, okay. And then I start getting feedback from Joe about where he's discovering how the power load is starting to interface with his gear. And then your feedback is starting to get more specific and focused. And I'm going, holy shit, he's really getting his head wrapped around this and spending time.
Joe got sciencey about it even when we were there on the day. Remember?
I reamped because I mean, the one thing about, like, I love all these demos that people do comparing two things, only it's two different performances or two different parts of the song. Check out this mic pre in the chorus and this one in the verse. Well, that's two different guitar parts, so it doesn't matter. So I go down the wormhole and reamp a guitar DI through a setup, and I measure the distance from the microphone or whatever. The day after you left, I went through every speaker simulator I had and put it through and said, okay, what's the Palmer sound like compared to this one? What does this one sound like to that one? What does the Fryad sound like to this one? And then I went through and did every IR, all 16, you know what I mean? And I'm going, all right. And I'm checking phase. I'm doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And this is the thing that I do on my days off. So when I'm in the heat of the moment, I don't have to go, oh, you know, this is weird or where it is. Like, I remember making the transition from tape to digital and just going, wow, I'm used to working at Sound City on a console, and I can turn the mic pre up two or three notches, and it's just fat and big and in your face. And now I'm at my studio on the same kind of mic pre, only the mic pre is not in the desk. And I'm going to digital. So what's the difference? Okay, well, there's a reference level in the digital world. So maybe I need to change my reference level to be a lower input That way I can turn my preamp back to where it goes. I mean, most people drive the line so loud, it's turning stuff down. Pads are, you know, a huge thing too. And so anyway, the point is, completely unsolicited, just went down the wormhole. And then everybody that walks in, and I don't get paid for any of this shit, you know, to me, like if somebody goes, hey, dude, I'll give you $100 for everyone you sell, I'd be like, that would make me a hypocrite. And I've had people offer that. Whatever, I'm a hypocrite if I go, yeah, you should buy this, because that's not me. I use it. Now, that being said, if it's great on one record, it might not be great on another record.
Right.
Times if you pulled out a Les Paul that you love that sounds amazing on a certain record, and next band comes in, you plug it in, it just doesn't work. For whatever reason, it doesn't work. So there is no set and, you know, tried and true anything to me.
Or maybe like you're like that as a musician. Maybe like, tools. On this that's record, I was tools. Really great. On this other record, I don't work.
I will tell you this though, man, and this is another thing. And I got out of preamps for a long time because as much as I love standalone preamps, I could never get them to work with a guitar rig. You know, I was like, sometimes you just get lucky and you pull out a half dozen amps that have effects returns and you plug them in there and you're like, okay, it's noisy, it sounds weird, or it doesn't really work, or should I go 6L6s, should I go EL34s, what's going on in the loop of this amp? You go down the rabbit hole, you're like, okay, I got a guitar sound out of there, whatever, who cares? But then I borrowed your, I don't even know the numbers, the big two rack.
The 292 power amp.
Power amp.
The 292,
And I go, what the hell's going on here, man? This thing is insane. And it's just every preamp I threw at it. I have a Mesa Studio preamp that I've never used on a record. I bought it while I was making a Pennywise record ages ago. And I can never get that thing to sound good, honestly, until I was working on a band and we plugged it into your power section. And I was like, holy crap, I don't need to buy a 2C Plus anymore. That thing is insane. And it's whatever you got going on. And so I tell friends of mine about it because I think, hey, you've got a preamp that I know you love that you might never use, and this could resurrect your thing. So that's just flat out. That's how I am. I don't need somebody to go, hey, you're getting kickback or whatever. You know, it's just stupid. I'm not that guy. I'm just like, this is legit and this is shit. And I'm the first guy to tell that to anybody.
Yeah, and we were like just blown away because, you know, this model has been in production since, God, 94, 95, you know, right. And it's been up and it's been down and it's been up and it's been down. And the trends have been power amp rigs, not, you know, vintage gear, more sophisticated modern stuff. Vintage gear, ebb and flow. And just when we think we're like, well, the rack thing is kind of coming back, but we're not really selling power amps these days by the different models based on how much power they put out. So we have the 252 power amp, which is actually 65 watts aside, but it's called 50. And then we have the 292, which is the one that you have. And then we have the little one space one, which is the LX2, which is also 50 watts aside, but it's 6L6s. Okay, so we have those three. And when people ask us, which one should I buy? I need a lot of headroom. It used to be a long time ago. It used to be the answer was you get the bigger power amp because more power gives you more headroom. That's not happening today. What's happening today is what nobody plays anywhere near loud enough to use all the power of the big power amps. It's not about that they put out power. It's that they have a certain sonic characteristic because they have all that headroom and reserve, that power and reserve that you're never, ever going to use. It would kill your dogs and cats if you turned it up to full volume. But there are people that will listen to the 252 and they'll listen to the 292 and they'll go, I like the 252. It's got more headroom because they don't know how to describe what they're hearing. It's certainly not headroom that they're talking about.
EL34s.
I'm sorry?
Is it EL34s in that one?
Yeah.
Well, you're listening to 34s versus 6L6s versus KT88s.
Yeah. And so when they're asking us what we recommend for them, we're not recommending that based on the power equation anymore. We're saying, well, you should have the 292, even if you're playing in your bedroom, because of the kind of gear that you're using or the kind of sonic result that you're trying to achieve and all that. So it's really funny right now, the reason that we used to sell more 252s because it had less power, because people wanted it to break up sooner. Right. Now we're selling more 292s, just like you, because it just happens to work really great in the application that you're familiar with it for.
It works great on any preamp I've thrown at it. And Keith Nelson, who I loaned it to him, he was like, the one thing I noticed is I can make small changes in my preamp now, and it totally makes sense. I would borrow, I would use preamps, all the PV Rockmaster and the ADA MP1 and all these crazy preamps that I have. And I I'm just like, man, Michael Wagner got that thing to sound incredible on Skid Row or whatever, So I'm like, how come I can't do it? And I don't know what he was doing. I think he was actually running into Macintosh power amps.
Interesting.
Anytime I go into a loop, and I would sit there and, I have a handful of amps out with loops in them, and you try it, and loops are all different. All loops are created different. So you make those minimal or maximal changes on your preamp, and it doesn't make difference because it's going into the loop of the amp and something just not really analyzing it or seeing it as that. But Keith brought up that point where he can make small adjustments to the preamp, and he's hearing them now because your amp, your power section is so clean and powerful, and it's worked out great so far. It's been amazing, and it's given me a new lease on all this other stuff that I have that I haven't used in ages, which another thing is like you're only as good as, everybody, I try not to be lazy on every record. I'm trying not to use the same tape echo or the same whatever, So being able to pull out the MP1 and use it on a track.
I saw that thing at the studio when we were there. I thought, hot damn.
It's killer. And the PV Rockmaster and all the little weird preamps that I have laying around. Now they've got this new lease on life, and it gives me a new opportunity to pull in amplifiers that I might never use, and even big proper amplifiers that I maybe not like the power section of, but the preamp had a great sound, so I could jack the preamp out of there into the power section of the 292. And so I'm excited about that. And but I did want to mention that my partner, a business partner named Chad Bamford, and he teaches classes at my studio. Before COVID, we were doing 2 or 3 sessions a year on our off times. And one of the tests we used to do is I have two, and it's not the most accurate test in the world, but I have two PV 6505s, and one's a 6534. So you got a 6L6 amp and you got an EL34 amp. And just being able to make that decision, so I'd set both amps exactly the same and play some guitar, and they're pretty well tuned together. I mean, and you can definitely hear the difference between a 6L6 tube and an EL34 tube. And that's some of the things that we, try to demonstrate, because most people don't even know that there's a difference in tube sound or headroom or quality or tone, or it's not just the preamp tube.
Yeah. We go through a lot of that trying to explain to people. It's like, it's not really the tube itself that's responsible for the big difference. It's the tube operating in the environment that it's operating in. The kind of the output transformer, the winding, the primary to secondary impedance ratio, the plate voltage, how much drive voltage is coming from the phase inverter to drive those power tubes. There's all these things. It's not just this one part where the tubes reside. There's everything leading up to the power tubes and everything that the power tubes are that everything is following the power tubes until you get to the speaker. You tend to optimize the different types of power tubes to those environments that are, they're kind of like they work. They're formulas that generally work, so you sort of hew to those formulas, and then you can sort of move out of the formulaic part of it to enhance some qualities of the response, the characteristic or something. Part of the whole thing about the Deliverance was putting KT88s in it, and people go, why didn't you put EL34s in it? And we did this thing a few shows ago where we had the Sound City amp with the EL34s, and we had the the Deliverance with KT-88s in it, and we're A-Bing them, and people are going, the Deliverance has got that really harmonic, rich, you know, power tube distortion kind of sound, blah, blah, blah. And we're going like, whoop, this is the one that you think has got that EL-34 vibe is the one with the KT-88s, and the one with that you think has got the big, bold, round sound, KT-80-ish sort of deal is the EL-34 amp, because the sonic cues that you're used to hearing were coming out of it that way. And we basically played sleight of hand with the amp design to do that, to show people, you know, it was partly to because we're having fun with KT-88s. I'm having fun working with KT-88s.
Designing with it. That Deliverance at one point, the one I borrowed didn't have 66s in it.
KT-66. No, it might've had 6550s in it.
That's what it was.
Kyle's from Bang Tango?
Yeah.
His has got 6550s in it. Only because at the time we made it, we were out of stock on the KT-88s, and he had a show to do with the Whiskey. So we put 6550s in it so he could get through the show at the Whiskey, and we just have never bothered going back and putting it right, so to speak. So that's what we had. You needed it right away, so here. Yeah.
It had a different sound to it. And for me, being a guitar player, I can feel it. That's the only way I can explain it. Like sometimes you want that bark, and sometimes you want the forgiveness. Mm-hmm. So it depends on, like, I find I personally favor 6L6s to the EL-34, but sometimes I just feel like I need the EL-34 for the clarity too. And sometimes it just depends on the track as well. I mean,
sure does. Yeah.
We got a 6V6 as well.
Well, we got a few guys here that are talking about KT-77s, which were originally the same British variation of 6CA7s as KT-88s were variations of the GE-6550. GEC KT-88s, GEC means General Electric Corporation, and the GEC tubes built in the UK were built by the General Electric division in the UK, and they had their own unique design of a high power industrial power tube, the KT-88. And the US side that was doing more development on efficiency and reliability and structural integrity and stuff had developed the 6550, which for the most part operates the same way, but the KT-88 has different sort of operational properties that give it its different signature. And So far, so good. But KT-77s are not made today the way KT-77s were made then, whereas KT-88s that are made now are made very similarly to KT-66s the way they were made in the 60s and 70s. So as a result, most of the KT-77s that are available now, people say, well, I have to change the bias on my amp. They're kind of cold sounding. Well, they're just dull, cold sounding tubes, no matter who makes them. And I think there's actually two makers, is JJ, and I think Electroharmonics some variation of the Russian output.
But you're saying historically they didn't sound that way?
Historically, earlier iteration? No, they sounded great. But the reissues of them, of all the tubes that are out there that have good sounding reissues associated with them, KT-77s are not getting that kind of love because there isn't a big enough demand in manufacturing for them to spend the time really tweaking them out. So what's out there are pretty generic and dull sounding, and there isn't any, let's see, who was talking about the bias of the KT-77s? Was it Nigel? I forget. But talking about, well, maybe you got to bias them a little hard. Yeah, you can try, but it's not going to really cut it. All the KT-77s that we run into and all the times that we tried to use them in the amps have just been like, why go to the effort when there's so many good sounding EL-34s out there, you know?
I personally just pick up an amp and I plug it in and I buy it, or I use it if I like it.
That's really where it's at right there.
Is this working or not? Sometimes you work on a record and the guitar player or the bass player is using something. You know, I remember like Justin from Tool using a Galen Kruger amp, and it sounded phenomenal. He's a phenomenal bass player, and his sound is world class. Mm-hmm. And then the next record I work on. I'm like, oh man, it was a really great bass sound. I'm gonna check out.
Let's one do of that things. Again.
Yeah, and you get that amp and you plug it in. You're like, huh? Yeah, it doesn't sound like that. You know, and to this day, you still know it's the player, but you know, every once in a while, you like to believe there's a little bit of juice in that amp that might do something, and that makes a difference. In the end, there really isn't. It comes down to the finger. So
yeah.
You know.
Well, my opinion about the tubes, I admit I'm really opinionated about some of these things. Tech Death Hippie says that why is Diezel always swearing by KT-77s? The whole Diezel mentality is completely different. His design ethos is different.
I've never seen one with KT-77s in it though. I've never personally played a Diezel with KT-77s in it. They've all had either 6L6s or real 34s in it.
Yeah, Peter Diezel is more OCD about excavating the junk in sound in an amplifier, getting it as pure sounding as possible to the point where, for some people it's too well refined it's refined to the point where it doesn't have a lot of mojo. I mean, there's something about that. They're tight, they're focused, they're distinctive sounding, and they're detailed. And unlike all those things,
that's what I've been looking for, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I just don't happen to be that guy. And that's great. Peter and I are old drinking buddies from way, way back. I guess he doesn't drink anymore, and more power to him. And I love the guy. He got started doing taking people's Marshalls and putting the Pitbull, modding them so that had our Pitbull gain stage modified into the Marshalls. That's how he got started. And then he developed his own ideas, and he took the anal retentive design ethos to like an extreme that I couldn't even imagine. And I looked inside of his amps and I'm going, wow. Yeah. Cool. Okay. Great. Great. That's out there, but it's too tight for my blood. You know, we developed the amps up to a point where they were just so squeaky tight that people were starting to revolt, you know, and when I actually went out and played one live, I went, yeah, this is a little tough. You know, I need to like loosen up the handcuffs inside it.
Which one was this? Was this an ultra lead?
I think it was just everything in general. It's at a certain point, about 93, 94. I just kind of went, I think it's time to like loosen up a little bit, not, you know, you don't have to fix everything to death kind of attitude. And, you know, that's a process. As a producer, you get into your craft, you get things tighter and tighter and tighter, and then you start going, this is all performative at this point.
Yeah, I mean, I played two amps last night, and one of them could go from squeaky clean to full throttle, and the other one could not clean up at all, and it sounded like it had a distortion on it the whole time. And I enjoyed both of them equally, because the one that sounded like it had a distortion on it had a unique sound. So that's part of what you strive to do, you know? So, you know, sometimes the squeaky clean works great. I mean, I remember hearing Helmet for the first time. I think he was using a ultra lead. Mm-hmm. And Fletcher from Pennywise, when we did Land of the Free, he had an ultra lead. And Mick Thompson from Slipknot used an ultra lead. And so there's, every once in a while, and I remember actually walking into a rehearsal room and Rob Caggiano was cutting some guitars. And I think he was using, I don't know if he was using the original Deliverance or a Sig X. And he had a lap. It was fucking crazy because I'm listening to it come out of these speakers going, holy crap, dude, that was one of the best guitar sounds I've ever heard. Like, what are you doing? And he's got like an interface and a laptop and a pair of speakers set up in a rehearsal room. And I was just like, oh, man. You know, like you walk away depressed and you're like, God damn it. Yeah. it just comes down to like, you know, also having the talent to be able to play to the amp. Like one of my biggest problems is when I'm dialing stuff in, I try to get the player to help dial it in, obviously, because it's going to feel a certain way. But sometimes you just need to add to the equation and then I'm tweaking. But usually I've tweaked the night before so I can feel what's going on. And then I'll change speaker cabinets and I'll change microphones and whatever, make sure everything's in phase and just at least going, you know, not going in blind and on somebody else's dime. So that's part of my fun experimental processes.
When you said something earlier that was just, go ahead, Steve.
When you get somebody, and I know this has happened to you, you get somebody in a studio that it just is so unorthodox. They come in with a weird guitar and a weird amp that you wouldn't even dream of letting in your studio. And they've got these weird chops and everything is wrong about the whole equation, except everything that's coming out of them is beautiful and nobody else can do the same thing or even duplicate it. That person has to play that guitar with that thing and just put it on record and let them do their deal. And then I imagine that you look at that and figure out, you have to figure out how you're going to, it's cool what they're doing. And then you have to figure out how that's all going to work in the big picture.
Well, I mean, to me, those moments are those are the moments you cherish because that was the identity. You know, sometimes the perfection, if I sat here and talked to you completely like this in a monotone voice the whole time, you're not really paying attention to me. But if I have that inflection and that weirdness, or I finger it slightly off and it's a little sharp, or I'm a little ahead of the beat, those are the moments that you're like, that's the identity. So like we're talking about Charlie Watts.
Yeah.
You iron out Charlie Watts's hi-hat or Phil Rudd's hi-hat. I've seen AC/DC with Phil Rudd and I've seen AC/DC with Chris Slade. Both times I love it. But there is a difference in the feel of the song. I've seen Soundgarden with Matt Chamberlain and Matt Cameron. Same thing. You hear the song, it's still a great song, but it feels different because of that drum where it's sitting. So those moments where, like, especially a guitar player comes in and you, I mean, to me, if you can hear the sound of the band, that's the key. Like,
right.
I remember ages ago, I did a band called Fair to Midland, and that guitar player played some of them. He had really long fingers. And it was the first time I've ever seen a guy use a Naylor amplifier, and he was using the reissue. I've seen Naylors in the past and I always liked them. And he was using a reissue from the guy in Texas who bought the company. And it sounded fantastic, but his style was so unorthodox, and he can go across like 8 frets from it was the most insane, but maybe like being a little nervous, and then, you know, and in the studio here, things a little bit clearer than normal. Like his parts were so great, but I couldn't quite get what I was looking exactly to happen. So I actually was like, sometimes you're just like, hey, just play the low strings and then play the high strings, or let's overdub as a reinforcement. And I do reinforce. I call it the enforcer. The Clint Eastwood track is what everybody's like, we doing Clint now or the enforcer. Sometimes it's just reinforce what just needs to poke out a little more. So you got your heavy rhythms and you got this intricate part, and it just feels great. It's a little sloppy, who cares? But if you want it to tighten up a little bit, you know, with the drum kit, I'm not going to go in there and grid edit that thing. That's just stupid. So I might maybe put the enforcer in there, add a little more of that clarity somehow. I mean, I did a band called Blackstone Cherry, and they had a dobro. I think it was a Dean dobro. And they would play
a Dean dobro.
It sounded incredible. I know. It's like, so I ended up buying a dobro and doubled all the rhythm guitars with this dobro. So you're adding the acoustic-y sound that's real jangly on top of that dense, thick electric sound. And it added that clarity. And it doesn't quite sound like a double, because it's, even though it's a second performance, it's a whole different texture. And
it doesn't sound like an acoustic guitar either. It's like,
no, it's a thing.
It's a thing, definitely.
On two Tool records ago, I mic'd up Justin's fingers when he played bass with his finger. You know, with his fingers, I mic'd up the strings, because you can hear the attack clearer.
The fingerprints.
It's a lesson that Garth Richardson told me. He was doing that first Mudvayne record, which is one of the great, like, when you put that thing on, the bass sound comes on, you're like, that is the most unique and interesting, cool bass sound I've ever heard. And he told me, like, the bass player would sit on the couch and play, and he's used to hearing the acoustic sound of his bass. And then you go in the studio and you plug it in and you got speakers going, and you're like, man, you lose that kind of intimacy you've had with your instrument. So he put some mics on the bass strings, you know, and that brought that intimacy back, and that kind of added this texture to a sound that I still, and to this day, remember that big bass sound, and that made me want to listen to the record as opposed to, you know, I think.
One of my key takeaways of being in your studio when we went over there was that everything that we talked about, every piece of guitar, amp, blah, 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 when the subject came up about a particular piece, not once did you ever say, oh, what a piece of shit. Every single piece of equipment that got brought up in a conversation, you went, yeah, that was really great sounding.
One man's trash and another man's treasure.
I brought up something or I mentioned something and I'm waiting for you to go, oh, that's a piece of shit. And you went like, no, that sounded really great. Or this sounded really great. And some of the things that I'm like, then I just go, yeah, you're listening to it. Your perspective is the tool in the toolbox that doesn't get used that often because a lot of people just sort of like don't gravitate towards it. But when you do find the right environment to put it into, it's perfect for that environment. It sounds great, but I don't think that way. I'm too stuck in my own sort of thing. It's guys like you that help pull me out of my head or out of my ass, whatever it is. It's
interesting that you say that because I have to really look out when I hang out with my friends who do what Joe does, because I can easily get into your headspace, which is like everything has a use. But why I have to guard against that is because then I'll have no money, because like there's always something new and amazing and quirky and bizarre that, oh yeah, and then I could do this on this record and oh yeah, and listen to that cool thing, because truly everything does have a use. It'll come around at some point that, you know, that little smoky cigarette guitar amp, you're going to mic that damn thing and it's going to be the sound that you needed for that bridge part, you know?
Well, sometimes in the studio, it comes down to inspiration. I mean, I've had singers before where I put the most incredible microphone in front of them and they're not inspired to sing in front of that, but you put the quirkiest looking mic and even though it sounds like shit, they're inspired to sing. So in the end, the performance is good. You're buying the performance. You're not. No one's analyzing the vocal sound. And if it sucks, I'll tweak it later and make it sound better. But if you're, and the other thing is, are you ready to go or not? You know, I mean, those days where you'd spend 4 days getting a kick drum sound, those days are gone. You know, I mean, at 4 days, you're like, I don't even want to play anymore. You know, in 4 days, you could have cut the whole record twice. So, you know. There are things that the one thing I will say, and I'm not so positive as you think, I am evil. There are things where I just go, hey, that sucks. And it's usually because it breaks, like it explodes every time. Or I'm an old mini amp and I love it. And it's a plexi 60 watt. And it's just, I can't get tubes for it to house it. It explodes every time I use it. It sounds incredible up to the moment of explosion. And then I have to replace a tube socket. And I'll do a tube socket at a time because I love to keep it in its integrity, you know. And then all of a sudden, then you get into Variax and you go down the wormhole of, you know, fatter tubes and coal biasing, whatever. In the end, everything has its purpose. I guess it's very
important. And some things' purpose is to be at the bottom of a dumpster, Joe.
Well, I mean, it's so funny, man. I remember walking into M Audio a long time ago and I had a friend that worked there. He's like, hey, we come and listen to our speakers. And I'm sitting in his room that no one should ever listen to speakers in. And and you're just like, okay, this is not ideal either, but I'll listen to your speakers. And I'm there with like Mike Patton or somebody, you know, and I'm listening to stuff. And what am I going to say? Yeah, it sounds great. I'm just going, hey, your speakers suck. So they take that and say, maybe we need to redesign our shit. So they go back and they tweak their stuff. And then later on, I love them. I honestly do love them. And they came out with a series of speakers. Unfortunately, they don't make them anymore. But I was doing work with Alan Mulder. He bought a pair. I bought two pairs. I'm like, these are great speakers. I still put them up when I'm cutting bass because they have a cool mid-range. It fits in with my picture. They can handle low end. And I put them up because when I don't want to blow up the delicate speaker and I'm cranking a little bit. And so, I mean, it wouldn't have done me any good saying, well, these things are fantastic. I mean, what am I going to say? You know, I've had $50,000 speakers in my room. They just don't work in my room. You know, that's the thing. It's just all.
You have a pretty interesting array of speakers in your room. I noticed you're not, you, like most stuff at your studio, you have a selection
of everything. Yeah, you know, and, well, I mean, the thing is, if I only mixed on NS10s and everybody in the world had NS10s, it would be fucking awesome. But people are on earbuds, people are on headphones, people are on big speakers with scooped out mid-range, people are on mid-forward speakers. So the more things I can listen to mixes on while I'm making a record, you know, and some things is, you know, some of the tool record was listening back to Adam Jones brought in on like a Bose, like Bluetooth speaker, that big.
Yeah.
Mine is orange and it's waterproof. Uh-huh. So, it's incredible. You know, the sound coming out of the thing for $99 and it's another way of listening to music and it's a reference. So.
Okay. At your stage of the game, Joe, do you ever go check your mixes in the car? Just like, does this translate?
I don't go to the car anymore because I have so many sets of speakers around me. Uh-huh. That I pretty much run the gamut. I mean, on my desk alone, I've got AR-18s or bookshelf speakers. I've got NHTs. I've got a small set of NHTs with a sub. I've got NS10s. I've got KRKs. I've got Radio Shacks with a crown.
But what I wonder is all of those are still being listened to in the same acoustic space.
Well, they're in different areas. See, that's the thing, too. They're not always in front of a pair of speakers. I've got a pair on the side. I've got a pair in the lounge. I've got a pair behind me. My headphones, sometimes I'll flip the headphones left and right because you know, I'm sitting here and I know I'm looking at you on the left and I'm looking at you on the right. And if you listen to a mix for 12 hours, you pretty much have that picture embedded in your head.
Yeah.
But if you guys switch places, now all of a sudden I'm hearing it and looking at it differently. So switching the right and left on your headphones or speakers, you know, it got a little confusing when I did a whole set of speakers backwards, but I have a set. I'm using a Jonathan little headphone amp and it's got a little left and right and left. And I can go back and forth. And as soon as you change that, you're like, oh my God, yeah, the hi-hat's incredibly loud or whatever.
You know, that's great.
Because you're so used to hearing it in one speaker for a bunch of hours, you don't really notice it anymore.
Uh-huh. Hey, there's a question here.
I'm wondering if it's a loaded question. I'm dying.
No. It's just, what's it like having George Massenberg master your work?
George Massenberg. Oh, George Massenberg has never mastered my work. So, Bob Ludwig.
There's the answer.
George Massenberg's not even a mastering engineer.
Ba-dum-bum, ba-dum-bum. Ooh. What symbol is that, Steve?
I just bought a mic that George Massenberg liked. Some kind of snare mic. I don't remember the name of it. Should never mention those things anyway, because now somebody's going to go, what is it? You're withholding information.
You don't want the price to be driven up on eBay.
Yeah. I don't care. That's the one thing when I hear people go, well, I don't want to tell anybody, man, because that's my secret weapon. I think it's actually kind of funny because nobody has the same ears. You can come mix a song in my room on my console with my gear, and it's not going to sound like me mixing it in the end. So
right.
It's just like guitar players. All right. So the extreme guitarist, Nuno Betancourt, the old saw that he Extreme was opening for Van Halen, and so Nuno goes, can I play through your rig? And yeah, sure. He says, so I plugged into Eddie's rig and started playing, and lo and behold, I just sounded like me.
Exactly.
Yeah, and then there's that story about Ted Nugent playing through Eddie's rig, like on the first tour or whatever. That same kind of thing.
And he still needs to have his ass knocked out regardless of what amp he's playing through, right?
But, I mean, that's the truth. Steve, I always think it's funny when you and I are sitting there playing through your amps. Because you and I couldn't sound any different, more different as guitar players.
That's why you come over, because I'm... First of all, I'm like enveloped in my own gases, so I can't even tell which way is up. And secondly... the way I play is just like you're talking about with the monitors. You hear it. I hear it the way I hear it, the way I hear it, the way I hear it.
Yeah.
And, but then I'm just as flighty as the average guitar player. As soon as I hear something different, It's like, oh, this sounds great. And it isn't that it was great. It's that it was different. Mm. It just, the change, the shift is the release. It's almost like a drug. When you listen to the same thing, you listen to yourself playing the same amp, the same riffs all the time, and then you play through something different and you play a little different, like when you're playing a Les Paul through this amp and blah, 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 and then you pick up a Tele and you play it into a different amp, you're a different guy and you like go, oh, this is great. It isn't really that your playing didn't change. It's just the way you hear it changed and you go, oh. And so I do this to myself, like, oh, this is a sound that our amp should have, and I could make it so that we can just do a little of this, and then it'll sound like that. It'll get that sound. And then Erico, the graphics designer and basically the general manager of the company that, like, runs everything and in heels backwards, and she's got this golden set of ears, and I go, listen to this. What do you think of this? And she goes, eh. It's not an interesting sound. And then Joe comes over and goes, hey, Joe, check this out. And he's like, yeah, that's okay. And I did that with, with Paige Hamilton one time with the Sig X, when the Sig X was first getting developed, when we were just like had the first prototype. And so you got to check this out. I want to get your feedback from it. And he's like, spent a half an hour playing with the clean sound, playing with the mid-gain sound, playing with the high-gain sound. I go, I like this. This is great. Yeah, this is cool. I like this. And after, I'm going, man, he's really into this. Huh. I hope we don't, like, ruin it with the Ultra Lead for him. Maybe he's going to like this better. Well, maybe that'll work better. I'm doing this. Maybe and then, might. And at the end, he, like, puts Den down the guitar and goes, yeah, I think you really got something here. It's not for me, but I think you really got something. You know?
Yeah. I like that too because that at least he knows what he wants, you know. That's awesome.
On the flip side, I remember we were at NAMM when the first time you brought the Sound City, Steve. You had the Sound City 50 watt and David Torn was at the show. And of course he's played the Deliverance 120 forever. And I remember he's playing the Sound City in the booth and he looks at me and he goes, "You know, I wonder how Steve's going to take it when I tell him that I probably want to switch my endorsement to another amp company. I think I'm going to go with Sound City."
I remember hearing that in that booth too.
Oh yeah. You were there.
Yeah. He's a great guitar player, man.
Oh yeah.
I mean, there's a guy who thinks outside the box for sure, man.
Box? What box?
Yeah. There's no box.
Yeah.
There's no box for that guy. That is like a woefully underappreciated, misunderstood artist that is.
He teases a box.
Well, he was using a Pierce stereo preamp when I worked with him. Assistant at a studio. And it was the first time I've seen anybody use three effects loops. Because I was like, what do you mean three effects loops? You know, an amp has one effects loop if it has an effects loop. Because, you know, when you get a Marshall, there's no effects loop in there. And he had a Pierce, and he had effects on the clean side. He had effects on the dirty side, and then he had effects that were global to the amplifier. And he was using LXP1s and Jammans and all these things that were creating loops and textures. And it was the first time I've ever seen anybody do that.
See, he's like the modern day, to me, he's the modern day expression of Hendrix in that he's not only willing to experiment that deeply with everything, every new thing that he comes across, but he has the ability to grasp it and do that, you know, so that you present that to any other typical guitar player. And they're like going, well, what do you do with this? And he's like in there calling me up going, okay, so we just need one more jack so that I can do. And then he lays out this.
It's rigged on your website, like how everything's patched together. I still have to go and study it just to go, what is actually happening here?
Yeah. He's got the Ether amp with a power station and then two more power stations that he's using as monoblocks for his wet rig, but he likes to set them slightly differently. And then his pedals and then his sampling thing. He actually gave me a map of like a little flowchart for it one time.
A map.
So that I could wrap my head around it. And once I looked at it, I went, oh, okay, now I get it. This is really straight ahead. What's really mind-boggling about it is that it's all spread out on the floor with duct tape. There's no paddleboard. Wow.
That's awesome.
You know, there's no paddleboards in baseball. It's just like all laying out on a floor. And it isn't randomly laid out on a floor, but it's all laid out on a floor and it's taped down. And he spends a lot of time getting it just right for the amp is here. The sampler is here. The pedal boards are kind of going diagonally over here. And everything is all geared to where the particular stage that he's on. And we've been buddies and working together for going on 20 years, right? 15, 20 years. And I went to one of his shows. He was in L.A. And I went to brought him down some gear. And he was playing at the Blue Whale. And so I walked up to him to say hello. And I walked really close to where his pedals were. And he like, don't step over there. And I'm like, ooh. Like I expected a landmine to go off or something like that. He just, his whole tenor changed, like, don't go over there. He was afraid that I might accidentally bump something and move. He had it so meticulously laid out, you couldn't even walk near his pedal arrangement. He had to walk around it.
Console.
And yeah, I was like, okay, he's getting ready for a gig. I know how that feels. Everything's got to be right so that you can like unhook. Because if anything gets messed up, you can't unhook. You can't relax and perform for the audience because there's something going, it's a quarter of an inch. It was a little bit of a shock, but I understood it. And then when I looked at his stuff on the floor, I realized he spent a good half an hour spreading all those out. And when I started thinking, well, you know, a board, but the way they're laid out, it would have to be a long, narrow board, and you can't take it on a plane that way.
Right,
it's got a
hinge
in it, and like, by the time he tries to figure it all out so that it's got hinges and angles and stuff, he's like, I know where I'm going to tape them. Why do I have to go to all that other extra effort? So
you got muscle memory too, or foot memory.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was the same at the NAMM show. When we got to the NAMM show, we had him a particular place where it was sort of a constricted area where he could stand and perform and stuff. And so, yeah, all the pedals were laid out relative to the space he had to work with. So it's a formula with him. Everything is a formula with him.
Speaking of formula, our time formula, I'm just bringing this up. I'm not saying it has to happen, but we're moving towards the 9:30 mark. We start wrapping it up or what?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think
I'm sounding the alarm. Doesn't have to be heated.
I think that we have covered a lot of really nice, interesting ground. I think we've drawn Joe out a little bit and kind of got into his head a little bit, and I've learned some things. And
I think Joe should come back on the show too.
Yeah, just going to be... There's always going to be this. It's what's really interesting. Every guest we've had so far has been like, you know, there's a whole lot. Torin did the same thing. There's a whole lot of stuff I wanted to cover that. Or after the day after the show, you know what? We didn't do blah, blah, blah. Okay, we'll do it again. So we can always do this again. And I really appreciate you making the time for us.
Yeah, of course.
And being able to swap stories and hear some things that I hadn't either thought about for a long time or didn't know, which is always wonderful to learn.
Yeah, I just want to learn the feet of the master.
I want to figure out Chris Minto, because I remember him being a great engineer, and I want to figure out if he's still doing it or what's he doing.
Yeah, because it would be great. It would be great to like have him go, oh, that guy with a cassette. Yeah, I remember that. I'd love to hear him like wax nostalgic about that one. That would be cool.
He did a bunch of loudness records at Sound City with Max Norman. I remember that.
Mm. Yeah, that would be cool. And I also wanted to get into, but this is a whole This is another hour. I wanted to get into recording in analog and then mixing to digital and then making vinyl off of that. Because the everybody I talk to gives me a different answer about the vinyl that results from that process doesn't seem to behave like vinyl that's 100% analog from beginning to end. And but that's a deeper subject, and I want to really delve into that. And I'll bet you have some real definitive ideas about that. Man,
just dealing with it, I learned a lot about vinyl and mastering for vinyl and things like that. So yeah, that goes deep. I mean, it's, we go into tape machines and formulations of tape and mastering and it's just, and then cutting and plating. And so, yeah, if you want to get, we'll get together another time and talk that.
Seven String Heaven is like, discuss it now. Don't wait. And We will. We don't want to drag Joe's face across the cement too many times. It's probably about time for your dog to take a walk.
Yeah, she actually just got off the couch and gave me the look. So maybe you heard her call her or something.
my cat's pissed off about something here. I don't know what her issue is, but she won't leave me alone.
No, my cat's.
So awesome. I'm going to go investigate when we get off.
All right. Well, I want to thank
Let's answer this one question. AC/DC uses the same equipment as they did for Back in Black, and the new albums sound like compressed small poo.
I don't think they do. I mean, I think like there was never an MP3 during Back in Black. So what were you referencing at that point? Quality vinyl, and maybe a first issue CD and a mastering job. So the mastering nowadays, it's almost in three-step process. I mean, you have to, back then you'd master and there was it, you were mastering for vinyl. Maybe you tape transfer that went to cassette, but there wasn't really a remaster for cassette. So now you have to master, if you really want to go to vinyl and make it sound good, you have to master to vinyl. And then you have to master for a CD, let's say. And then you also have to master for streaming services, and then they all sound different. You put on the same song on YouTube and Spotify and Tidal and whatever, and they all sound different. So you have to figure out an average. You can't master 1,000 times. So Back in Black sounds great to me because it's a great song. It's a great album, and it doesn't matter what you play it on. It sounds killer. The new AC/DC to me, I'm not sure about the last record because I'm not listening to it yet. The previous one, I thought, reminded me of early AC/DC, and not sonically, who cares? It reminded me of these dudes singing background vocals like early AC/DC, and Phil Rudd playing like AC/DC, and the guitar sound. I mean, you're not gonna mess up Angus's guitar sound. You're gonna capture it. Mike and Brendan O'Brien did the records, and you can tell there's a comfort in there, and who cares? I mean, it's either you like the song or you don't. Right? If you like a song, it could be horribly recorded, and it's still a great song and you still like it. So if you don't like it, maybe you just don't like the song.
You don't necessarily know this about me, but my wife and I are vinyl junkies big time. And she's got the disease way, way worse than I will ever have it. She's got different pressings from different regions. She's got the Japanese pressing, the UK pressing, the US version that's got the side from the first master, the A side for the first master, and the B side from the second master. Blah, 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 blah. She's got all this stuff, and she will buy all these, and then we'll sit around and audition them for 3 or 4 days and talk about how they're different. And we do it all the time.
This
is her most recent.
That's killer. I mean, think about this: you're Van Halen. You've sold a shit ton of records, so now you've got to come up with this demand. You can't go to one mastering guy and have him master it and then duplicate that much vinyl. You're probably going to master it by two or three different people. Send the tape here, make a copy of the tape, send it to that person, let them master it. Or you're making duplicate tapes to send to different places to print. So everything sounds different. Now you just, here it is. It's digital. You spit out a million CDs or whatever, or, you know, now you don't even make CDs, but let's say you spit out a million CDs and they're pretty much identical. No one's really analyzing the glass that this one was cut on versus the glass that one was cut on. It's the same speed. It's the same everything. But back then with vinyl, it was a wild card. You need another pressing. Okay. That pressing is going to sound different than this other pressing. Maybe you're going to remaster it, or maybe you're going to send it to another plant and they're doing a different process to it. So,
what happens with this is the same thing that happens with amps and IRs and IRs versus analog cabs and everything, is that once you start listening to it and you get acclimated to it, you go, I like that.
Yeah.
Until you hear the other thing, and then you go, oh, I like that better. And then you get acclimated to it. Yeah. And then you go back to the one that you don't like anymore, and it's like, oh, wait a minute. This has got another...
And then you go around the carousel and you realize, no, I like this from this version, this from this version, this from this version. And I wish I could average them all together.
Well, to me, it's a tool. If you're a decent enough musician, you can play a clean DI with a plugin on it. And as long as there's no latency, who cares?
Right. I agree.
Half the stuff that I mix is usually there's a guitar part done in Guitar Rig.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, well, we can try to recreate that, or we can just use that. Unless, why not use it? The performance is great. So
I've detected an underlying theme of your whole presentation tonight, which is, it's music. If it sounds great, who fucking cares?
Exactly. I couldn't tell you John Lennon was distorted till like maybe 15 years ago. I was like, oh, he's distorted on this song, really? I never heard it on that. I'm really.
Yeah, yeah. Who cares?
All those years of listening to R&B and stuff, you're just going, oh man, that mic is really blown up. Wow, it's kind of cool, actually. Or
yeah,
I remember the day I walked into the studio and Deep Purple was on. I go, holy crap, John Lord has got an amazing guitar sound.
Right,
he's playing this organ. His sound is massive, you know. And then I'm like, well, how come I can't get that out of that dainty little keyboard in the studio? Oh, I can. I'll plug it through. Why not? You know. Who cares? I get mixed comments. It's my favorite one. Hey, it's a little distorted. I'm like, I don't hear it. I don't hear distortion anymore. It's part of the sound, you know.
Yeah. It's just seasoning. It's just seasoning.
Here's the best one. A record label calls and goes, "Yo, yeah, they've listened back to the mastering and they're documenting the master to go to pressing." I'm like, there's a little noise on the end of that song. I'm like, yeah, it's called amp hiss. You would know what that sounds like if you actually heard a real amp. or like tape hiss. What is that? All that noise, man. I'm like, it's called tape hiss. They put on an old record, that's what it does. It's like ridiculous to me.
All right. We have we obviously have really scratched the surface. And again, it's a privilege having you. Our fans out there, obviously, we're really into it, so thanks mucho. And we'll be doing this again.
Awesome. Well, thanks for having me.
Absolutely, Joe.
You guys have a great weekend. I'm gonna get a refill and walk my dog.
All right.
We have some fun outro music, right?
Goes a little something like,
you got a little something to play this. Us out.
Until we meet again, happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then, happy trails to you.